wanted freedom. Adjust the frames, got keys to kingdom. Unlocking chains, sober the podcast. Open up your brains, sober the podcast. Let's get it, man. Yeah.
Welcome back to another episode of Sober the Podcast with your host, Bradley Saxon. We got Clifton Nobles in the house, but we got a special guest tonight, Mr. Yeah. Al Harris.
Yeah, for sure, man. I'm glad to be here.
Yeah, man. We're so glad for you to be here. But let us tell you something we started that's a new tradition at the lab at Sober the Podcast. You see this basketball goal, and so here's what we've been doing. At the beginning of the show, we've been either asking our guests three questions concerning sports history, or we play some old songs and you get a chance to tell us who the artist is.
Okay.
And so today I'm going to play a couple songs, and if you choose the artist, like if you know who the artist is up to three times, at the end of the show you get a shot and you get to win some free merchandise.
Okay.
So it's been something that we've added that I think has just sort of been the icebreaker.
Okay.
To be able to get things in. So me and Clifton picked these songs out, but we're going to see really what you know about some old school hip hop, which I have 100% confidence you probably going to get all of these, okay? So you'll hear it playing through your headphones. The first one is a classic, a little throwback. I've actually been vibing to this lately.
Okay. Oh, yeah, that's my jam.
You know who that is?
Yeah, for sure. Come on, man.
Who is that? Yo,
they would crucify me if I didn't.
Yeah, they would.
Okay. You tell the people who that is?
That's Aaliyah.
Aaliyah. Yes, that's one. Okay, yeah. So let me go a little bit further back here, and you know what? I'm going to switch it up, Cliff. I didn't play this one for you. Let's see if he knows who this is.
Come on, man.
I ain't gonna stump you, Ama.
Hey.
The question is, do you know the lyrics?
Yeah. I mean, I know the lyrics. I know who it is, man. You know, as a jit coming up, man. You know,
that was it.
This was in the house, bro. This was in the house like ramen noodles.
Yeah.
It was the song to ramen noodles. Yeah. Yeah.
And tell the folks who that is.
That's Tevin Campbell.
Tevin Campbell.
Absolutely.
Hey, I actually sampled that.
That actual instrumental.
Can we talk? Just the voice and my engineer, he kind of merged it, you know, merged the beat in with it, you know. It's on the album No Weapon Form.
Yeah.
As a matter of fact, it's called Can We Talk?
That's funny that you didn't even have that one, but you changed it at the last.
Oh, that's crazy.
Yeah.
Well,
yeah.
Last but not least, huh? You know who this is?
That was quick.
Yeah.
This is off your new album.
That's off my new album.
And it's entitled No Weapon Form.
Absolutely.
Yeah, so
I know they finna hate me. Hey, listen, man, you can't do that to me, bro.
Yeah.
You can't do that to me, bro.
Well, so
you
could
have turned this into something.
Yeah,
else.
So look, man, before we jump in, like tell the people like who you are. Like tell them how they can listen to this music, because that's one thing that we want to do through this is, you know, I say this all the time, man. Like I don't know if you remember this, but we met on Old Stone Church Road, the church we did the youth conference at.
Yeah.
But like, it's one, like when I heard you speak, I knew like there's something on him. And I said, this cat is kingdom. And I was instantly drawn to you. And so one of the things we like to do from this platform is to give people their flowers. And so we want to make a space to where you can let the folk know, this is who I am, but this is also how you can support what God is doing in my life.
All right.
So let them know who you are and tell them how they can listen to this latest album, No Weapon Formed.
My name's Al Harris. I'm an artist. I'm a minister. A minister first. A minister in many aspects. I just dropped an album called No Weapon Formed, September 24th. And it's on all outlets, all platforms.
Spotify, Apple, Google Amazon, Play, Apple, YouTube.
Everywhere on YouTube, you name it. Just type in Al Harris, No Weapon Form.
That's with one S.
That's with one S.
That's that. H-A-R-R-I-S. Yeah, Harris. Yeah. Get that right.
That's one S. Yeah. But yeah, it's been a journey, bro. You know, because I was sitting on the album for a while. I was sitting on the album about 2 years.
Oh, wow.
And before that was Fit for a King.
Yeah.
Fit for a King went from an album to a clothing brand, a clothing line.
You still doing the clothing?
I'm still doing the clothing. I'm still doing the clothing. I have a few things, a few selections. I'm not as big on it as I was, you know.
That's a tall task, though. A lot of people don't understand. That's an entity in itself.
Definitely.
A lot of work.
Yeah.
But, you know, it was some things that came into play that shifted my time, me being able to use my time. So it was either tire myself out, you know, or kind of fall back from the
had to pull something out there.
Yeah. So, yeah. But with that, man, I kind of dove deep into the music.
Yeah.
And I found you evolve.
Yeah, 100%.
You evolve. Anything that you do consistently, you're going to get great. You're going to get better at. Yeah, you're going to get good at.
Yeah,
you
know 100%.
I mean? And don't have a passion for it. Don't have a love for it. I mean, a love for it.
Yeah.
You know, to where you can do it for hours and it's not, it doesn't faze you. Yes. You know what I'm saying? Yes. And when you leave it, you're still thinking about it.
Yeah.
Or you do it and it fills you.
Mm.
Yeah. That's like a guy asked me one time. He was like, how do you know if you're called to preach? And I said, because when I give it out, it fills me.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. Well, and it's also that thing, even I feel like when we've done some things that put us in valleys, like when we do things sometimes, if we've made mistakes in our life, went through some affliction, like the affliction can't even steal that thing. Mm. Like you come out of it and you still want to do it. Why? Because man didn't give it to you. You know, God gave it to you. Yeah. And it's like the affliction was meant to steal the dream, but the affliction really is what polishes your gifting to be able to fulfill those dreams. Yeah. You know what I'm saying?
Absolutely. Sure. Absolutely. And that's how you know you're called, you know. When pain makes you want to quit, but purpose makes you stay.
Yeah. Yeah, that's, I mean, I've been, I can't tell you how many times I wanted to quit, but whatever that switch is God done turned on in us, that purpose, you just can't, even if you want to.
Right.
Yeah. So are you from Anderson?
No, I'm from Greenville. Okay. Greenville, South Carolina. Okay. Yeah.
Was you born and raised in Greenville?
I was born and raised in Greenville. My mother, I mean, my father and my grandmother, my father's mother, they're from New York. When my dad came down south, he met my mom and he had, you know, and they had me or whatever. So, you know, I would take trips
back
and
forth
back to New
York.
What
part of New York?
You know, Harlem. Harlem. St. Nick. Yeah. But we would go from Harlem to Long Island because my Uncle Sam, he was a police officer. He stayed in Long Island. So we would, you know what I mean? We would, travel, go over the bridge, go from the city to Long Island, man. And we would stay with him for a while, and then we would go back to the city. But that's when I found my love for hip hop, for music.
So what time frame was this?
I was 13. I was 13 years old. I had an EP that I dropped. It's called On Assignment, and that cover for On Assignment is me in New York. Me and my cousin. We're in front of the stoop. We little bitty boys, you know what
13.
I mean?
13.
I was 13.
So when was this, the 90s?
Yeah, this
How
was,
old are you?
This was like 98, 90. I'm 40.
Okay, all right.
He's my age.
Yeah, but listen.
You closer to 50.
Hey. Yeah.
Okay. I'm kidding. What about 44? About 44
yeah,
44, now.
44, yeah.
That seems a long ways from us,
but,
Al.
But the stigma with age and, you know, you need to, you know, you can't do it because you're too old type thing. I curse that stigma, you know. I you know what I'm saying, because I don't think there's a cap, especially with God.
Yeah, I heard Killer Mike talking about
man,
that just
he
recently.
He just got
didn't
three Grammys,
yeah,
bro.
Yeah, yeah. Can
and
I just
like
say
40,
that?
Yeah, right?
Yeah. Can I just say that might be one of the best albums of the year that I've ever heard?
Come on, man. Like, I mean, composed.
I'm telling you,
like
the artwork, like the talent, like it's hands down one of the best albums that I've heard in a long time, bro.
Right.
And he's not, you know, look, man. I get some of the content, but dude, there's some things on there that he's talking about. He's
well,
really.
I ain't gonna lie. I ain't heard it, but I saw his speech.
Yes.
So I didn't even know he was up to win, But tells you how far out of it I am. Yeah. But I was surprised that he won Album of the Year.
Yeah, it was that good.
What else
bro.
Did he win? It was three, wasn't it?
I'm not sure.
He won three. He won best,
the
best album,
like
best album of the year, best song of the year, best wow. I don't know, but it was three. It was because I didn't watch it.
Yeah,
I didn't watch it myself. I'm just seeing little clips of it here and there. You know the industry, man. It's a part of the industry that I don't associate with.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. You know what I'm saying?
Well, I mean, their agenda is a little different than our agenda.
Man, listen. And they put it in your face. Yeah. You know what I'm saying? Like, this is what we want from you. Are you with it? And and people signing left and right. And you're giving up so much more than what you could ever get from
Absolutely.
Them.
Absolutely.
You know what I'm saying? You're giving up so much more.
Yeah.
But anyway, you know, that's another I'm not saying they can't be, I don't know if they could be useful, if they could be, you know, people in the industry could be useful for a rapper's career. You know, you got deals you can sign that you don't have to be fully committed
Sell
to.
Sell your soul to.
Industry. Absolutely. Yeah.
But let's be honest, bro. Like, I think all three of us can say that we've been raised by hip-hop music. Like,
oh, definitely.
You know, I mean, at the age of 12, sure. bro, like, and my mom didn't know no different, man. But, I mean, I got Snoop Dogg, Doggy Style in my stocking, along with DRS, Dirty Rotten Scoundrels. You remember them? Gangsta Lean.
Oh, yeah, definitely.
And
definitely,
so, like, yeah. I'm in my room. Like, I'm not in Christ, bro. Like, I'm in my room listening to this, and I really feel like that was my pastor. Right. Like, that shaped my outlook towards so many things, you know?
Yeah.
And so life hasn't always been the way that it is now for us. Like, we've not always been, you know, selling hope to the community, giving back to the community. I say that there's always been a time in our life, man, where we was wide open. And so, Al, won't you tell us a little bit about that, your upbringing? And, you know, you've shared a little bit about being 13 and having that love for music.
Yeah.
But tell us a little bit more.
I mean, if we were to go before the age of 13, me with my grandmother, my mother, she handed me over at the age of five.
Okay.
And at the beginning of No Weapon Form, the album I just dropped, my mother is speaking.
Oh, wow.
Yeah. And she speaks about being in a crack house, being pregnant.
Mm. With you?
No, that wasn't me.
Okay.
That wasn't me. That was my brother under me.
Mm-hmm.
That was my brother under me.
So are you? How many brothers and sisters you have?
It's seven of us.
Seven of
us. It's seven of us. I'm the I'm the oldest.
Oh wow.
I'm the oldest. So that was my brother under me. But nevertheless, it was powerful, and I put it there, because she didn't want to leave the crack house, even though she was about to go into labor. She didn't want to leave the crack house. And then she said she don't even know how she got to the hospital. She got to the hospital, had my brother. He wore 3 pounds. He was 3 pounds when he came out.
Mm-hmm.
And then she goes to say how she left the hospital and left him there. And then, of course, social services take over and they take the baby. And you know what I mean? But the streets had her. The streets had her. So when I was 5 years old, my mother gave me up. She gave me to my grandmother, and I didn't know why at the time, but later I found out she was addicted to crack cocaine.
Mm-hmm.
You know, it started with cocaine, and then it led to crack, you know, with my mom. Mm-hmm. All I knew is that I had to live with my grandmother, and I couldn't see my mom no more, you know. I love my mom, and I would hear my grandmother, like, you know.
Real quick, if you could, so I run a women's ministry,
right?
And there's a lot of women who have lost their children. They're either in DFACS care or foster care, or
right.
Share a little bit more on that from the perspective of the child, as you go to your grandmother's house and you don't understand what's going on. If you could just share a little bit of that, because some of these ladies are going to be listening to this.
All right. Absolutely. As far as like the foster care system, I wouldn't know. My brothers would. My brothers under me, they went to foster care.
Mm-hmm.
Me, I went with my grandmother.
Mm-hmm.
So, but the feeling, and honestly, my grandmother was all I knew. Mm-hmm. All I knew. I probably had faint images of my mom, and when I would see her, that would make me like, oh, I want my mama. I know I got a mama, mm-hmm. and I remember I was with her. You know, I got slight memories of mm-hmm. me being with her, but I was young.
Yeah.
You know what I'm saying? So really all I knew was my grandmother.
Yeah.
You know, until I got like 10, 13 years old, when my mother regained custody of me. Mm. She came back and got me, you know, but by that time, the streets had me.
Mm.
You know what I'm saying? Because me and my grandmother, around six, seven years old, she would have me in the yard, front yard, raking leaves, bagging leaves, cleaning gutters. She would have us walk to the laundromat, everything. We were in the hood, so, you know, everything was in close proximity. You know, yeah. We had Balo like a half a mile down the street. We had the Washerette, you know, probably like a quarter mile around the corner. You know, so we would walk. If we're not taking public transportation, the city bus, we walk in.
Yeah.
And she would have these baskets that we would put the groceries in or the clothes in or something like that, whatever we were doing that day. And I remember me and my grandmother, man, you know, and she always let me know, don't nothing come to a sleeper but a dream.
Mm.
Don't nothing come. She say, do something with yourself, baby.
Mm-hmm.
Be something when you get older, you know, because she knew what my mom and my dad was. I didn't, but she did.
She did.
She knew exactly what they were doing.
Mm-hmm.
You know what I mean? And you know.
Was it just you that she had, or did she have some of your brothers and sisters?
None of my brothers and sisters, okay. but cousins of mine.
I got you.
Like all of us stayed at Big Ma house.
Yeah. Yeah.
You know, it was me, my cousins. We was at Big Ma house. Me, my cousin Shantice, man, that's my big sister. Mm. That's how we grow up with deeper bonds than just cousins.
Yeah.
Even though that's my cousin, that's my sister.
It's deeper, yeah.
That's my sister, man. You know, not just Shantice, but Precious Harris. We grew up in the same household because I was never stable. Yeah. You know, if I wasn't with my grandmother, when she get tired a little bit, you know, I might go with my aunts.
Yeah,
I might go with my cousins. You know what I'm saying? Pack a few things, and I might go over here for a while, man, just to give her a break.
Yeah,
you know what I mean? That was my whole childhood, bro. Mm. That was my whole childhood, bro. You know what I'm saying? And I'm having to adjust to people buying me things and taking them.
Yeah.
My daddy bought me a Super Nintendo, man, and came back and bagged it up and took it, man. You know, those are things you remember because those are things that had so much effect on you, man. Yeah.
Yes.
I was a kid, bro. Yeah.
But that's, you know, that's literally rejection.
Mm-hmm.
We don't say at the time when they do that, oh, that's rejection. But that feeling, bro.
Yeah,
we never forget that.
Nah, we don't forget it, bro.
We never forget it. You know,
we don't forget it, bro. And that's small. That's slight, man. That's slight when it comes to things that happen to me.
Yeah,
you know what I mean. Trying to come up, trying to figure it out.
Yeah,
you know, not having direction, not having a male figure in my life saying, "Hey, boy, you could do something with yourself. You got talent. I see something in you.
Right.
You know, let me set you up here, man." And you know, I didn't have that. Instead, I had the streets, man. Dope boy shining. Mm-hmm. You know what I'm saying? And yeah, you can blame these young black boys on how they live, man. If you know what I'm saying, yeah, you can point at them and criticize them for living the way that they live. But you got to understand, there's a backstory.
Oh,
there's
yeah.
a reason why they live like that.
Yeah,
that's all they know. They ain't never been shown nothing else.
Yeah, well. People are so superficial, Al. They don't want to believe that this is a lot deeper than what you see.
Yeah.
And I tell people all the time, man, like, not everybody got the same 24 hours in a day.
Mm.
And nobody wants to talk about this, but it's clear that in society that the color of your skin sometimes can put you at a disadvantage.
That's facts, man.
You know, and so a lot of what we see these kids doing is true. It's what they know. It's all they know.
Yeah.
It's they ran to the streets for acceptance. And let me tell you something. When you gonna get acceptance from the Dope Boys, I promise you, you taking it. Like you feel like you belong to something. Even though these are things that are not good for you, when somebody is accepting you, it's a different feeling than when your daddy comes and takes that Super Nintendo.
Mm-hmm.
You know what I'm saying? And so you run to fill that void, bro. And when people show up like that, you love them.
Yeah.
You really do love them.
You said it. I was waiting on it. I was waiting on that. You love them, bro.
Yeah.
You know what I'm saying? They become family. You build a stronger bond with the Dope Boys who handing you a few dollars here and there or teaching you the crack game so you can go out there and get money on your own. Even though, like you said, it's not right. It's not right. Why are you prepping that boy to be a runner for you and go out here and get money? Because ain't nobody else showing him how to get money out here.
Yeah.
You know what I'm saying? He too young to work.
Well, you would imagine he's showing you what somebody showed him.
Absolutely.
I mean, if there was something else to show you, that he would have.
Yeah.
And my dad was the same way, dude. My dad was a drug dealer my whole life. When I was 16, he handed me an ounce of pot and said, learn how to make money. And so at a very young age, what I knew was that there's a way to make money doing this. And it's all I really knew because I was never really employable. Like, I didn't until I got sober and met Jesus, I never kept a job. I sold drugs. But the problem with me was after a while, I couldn't sell them no more because I was doing them.
Right.
And so your mom comes back and gets you at 13, but you said the streets had you.
Yeah.
What'd that look like?
I mean,
Was you using drugs at this time?
Nah.
You was just hanging around the older cats.
I was hanging around the older cats, man, and I was soaking up the game.
Yeah.
I was soaking up the game. I might have handled drugs, you know what I'm saying? And that's just out of curiosity.
Yeah.
You know what I'm saying? Being around my big homies over in Fieldcrest, man, and just getting into mischief. You know what I'm saying? Just being ghetto babies. Yeah. You know what I'm saying? That was fun to us though.
Yeah.
Whether it's throwing rocks at windows, breaking glass, whether it's you know, setting dumpsters on fire, you know what I'm saying? Shooting firecrackers at the police, you know what I'm saying? Those are things that we did, you know what I mean? Or watching the strip, you know, because that's when all the cars come through right there on the strip. They come through with their fancy wheels. You know, people get dressed just to sit at the strip, man. We sitting at the strip. That was our Hollywood. The hood was our Hollywood, man. You know, people would show up for the hood. You know what I mean? I mean, it was so much love there. It was, and it felt good.
Yeah.
You know, even though it was dangerous, highly dangerous,
yeah,
it felt good.
Yeah.
You know, and it felt like home. You know, and that's what it's a difference between being in the hood and just being from the hood. You know what I'm saying? Being in, you know what I mean? Because I was engulfed in the hood.
Yeah.
You know,
Now you say it was love. Do you still feel that way now? We all said it was love and it feels like that in the beginning,
mm-hmm.
But now where you are looking back on it, do you still feel it was love?
That's a good question. And I don't think there's a wrong answer. Now it's clearly,
I'm just curious.
No, it's not a wrong answer. It's not a wrong answer. But the answer just has many layers because what is love? You know what I'm saying? What did I think was love when I was coming up out there?
Right, exactly,
yeah.
What did I think was love?
Yeah.
You pay me some attention.
Absolutely.
Yeah.
You had time for me?
Yeah. Right.
Oh, you had time for me.
Yeah.
You know what I'm saying? Whatever it was. And the fact that you would show me how to provide for myself and my family, even though it's wrong, man, you love me, man, and I love you.
Yeah.
You know what I'm saying?
Sure. That's, and you're loyal to that.
Yeah, you're loyal to it. Yeah.
Yeah.
Yeah. It's good.
Yeah, I mean, and I think, man, that... like you said earlier, man, as we evolve, man, that word takes on a new meaning. You know what I'm saying? And when we come up and we make something of ourselves, we intentionally go back to these places to be able to guide somebody with that same love, but in a different trajectory. Right. Because, I mean, here's the truth, man. Like, none of us want our kids to grow up with the dope boys. You know what I'm saying?
Right.
This is a different generation, cuz. Like, we survived that. Like, I remember, like you said, like, daddy's partying, mama's getting drunk. Like, you ain't at home, cuz. Like, you going to grandma's, you going to auntie's house. Like, that's what I did. Like, no stability. You know what I mean? But this day and age, man, like, it breaks my heart because some of these kids I meet, they ain't never had a grandma. And, dude, I'm going to tell you, I love my mama, but I don't know where I would be without my grandmother. And I can't tell you how many of these guys I've met that has never had the love of a grandmother.
That's crazy.
Mm-hmm.
Dude, and I feel like in the 90s, bro, like, I stayed at grandma's house. You could sleep in the trailer with the door open.
Right.
Screen door, and you ain't had to worry about people running up on you. There was a sense of loyalty back in the day in the game, bro.
Yeah.
But I'm telling you now, bro, people rather kill you, shoot you, didn't talk to you. And I'm not saying that that kind of stuff may not have been going on then, but, you know, there was a sense of loyalty back in the day, you know. But
I wonder if it was or if we were just young and it looked that way.
It could have just looked that way.
I don't know.
But I felt like, man, you didn't really, at least if there was disloyalty, you fought it out and then you picked yourself back up.
Oh, we fought a lot. But we fought a lot, man. It was less shooting.
Yeah, there
it was less shooting. We didn't have as many options when it came to pistols.
You didn't have a 357 snub nose with a three finger grip.
You didn't have an extended clip. Forties with the stick.
Now you can get a silencer legally.
And listen, man.
Crazy.
Yeah, you didn't. I don't even know if they sold those then, bro.
That's wild, man.
But dude, I mean, look at us, bro.
That's wild, man.
Like, here is what I believe God had a plan for our life.
Yeah.
So back to when your mama got you. Just curious, because I don't know you. I want to hear more about your story. I want to get to know you.
It's powerful, bro.
For sure.
So your mom comes to get you 13.
Yeah, my mom.
Did she get sober at that time? Is that how she got you? Or
yeah, she was sober for the moment.
Mm-hmm.
She was sober for the moment. My mom.
How'd she get sober?
Just quit? Shepherd's Gate.
Okay.
Oh.
Okay.
Well, time?
Huh?
At that time?
Yeah.
Okay.
At that time.
Because Shepherd Gate's been around that long, hasn't it?
You doggone right. And they're still here.
I'm just saying, shout out.
Is that a road
shout
here?
Shout out to Shepherd's Gate.
That's an extension of
Miracle Hill, the women's facility.
Right. Okay.
But, yeah, like, they've been around for, like, 50-something years.
Yeah.
And so, I
owe a lot to Shepherd's Gate, man, because we would go visit my mom at Shepherd's Gate. They put her in the home. They put her there and, you know, kept her active, you know, gave her things to do, man, made her feel like, you know, she was useful. All the while she was getting clean, you know. We would go visit her, sit on the back, you know, out in the, but they had a little park area, basketball go, and we would just have fun, man. Visiting my mom there, and I still remember to this day. She came and regained custody of me, and I was like, what, about 13, 14 years old. I had just came back from New York. Visiting family, and I stayed up there for a few months, I believe the whole summer or something at that time. So when I came back, you know, I'm hit with this. You know, we had to go to court and everything. It was crazy. I still remember being in the courtroom. My dad was there, my grandmother was there. And I still remember there was no fight. It was like everything was agreed upon. Everything was, it just went smooth. You know what I'm saying? And I'm like, what that mean? You know, and, you know, I understood I had to go stay with my mom. Mm. And I'm like, nah, I don't want to go stay with my mama. I don't want to, you know, I want to stay with you. I told my grandma that. I told my big mom, I want to stay with you. You know, I ain't even talk to my daddy because really me and my daddy didn't have that bond. I never had that bond with my father. Mm-hmm. I never had that bond with my father. Whenever I seen my father, man, most of the time it was in passing. You know what I'm saying?
Yeah.
Or he would come to the house, you know, and I'm not bashing my daddy. Don't get me wrong, y'all, because I love my daddy to this day. I just went and seen him yesterday. Took him some chicken, man, and he eat good, man, and talk a lot of junk, you know what I mean? But we got a stronger bond now than I did when we was younger.
Yeah. What's that bar you hit on that track with Chase when you said the margin? I know my daddy went. What'd you say there?
I said,
you know what I'm talking about?
Yeah, I know exactly what you're talking about.
You know my dad want to see me because my child don't see him often. What'd you say?
And I know my daddy misses his child because I don't see him often. I've been busy lately that I received the call.
Working the margin.
Yeah,
boy,
yeah,
you killed me like with that. I know I like put that. You on the spot. But I thought about that. I said, boy.
Yeah. I mean, everything I put in rap, everything I put in my music, man, it's real, man. It's true.
Yeah.
I feel like that's the only way you should be an artist and put out stuff. If it's real. You know what I'm saying? Don't put out something that's fake or put out something that's promoting or highlighting something that you know is detrimental to our youth.
Yeah.
Don't put that out.
Yeah.
You know what I'm saying? You could say that. Say that. You could be more creative doing the right thing.
Yeah.
You know what I mean? Believe me. Go check that No Weapon Formed out.
Yeah.
You know what I'm saying? And I'm confident in that. I'm confident in the gift that God has given me. You know, because I know that it's catered to a selective people.
Yeah.
Yeah, a selective people, man, it's catered to. And I pray that God has his way with the music, has his way with the ministry, that he has his way with my life.
Yeah.
Because I owe him that.
Amen. Yeah.
I owe him that, bro. We'll be here at 7 in the morning, man. I'm telling you.
Talking about this.
We'll be here at 7 in the morning, bro.
You know what that means, though? You be unemployed.
Huh? I
can't come tonight.
I might be unemployed, but I always got a job.
Oh, yeah, because that's good, man, because God going to get you what's yours.
You better believe it, boy.
Yeah.
You better believe it, man.
So you were forced to go with your mom. You didn't have a choice.
I ain't have a choice. It was court ordered. So, yeah, I had to go, you know.
Did that make you angry? Like,
yeah, it made
me
angry.
Do you feel like from that point forward is really when you started internally becoming very angry? Or do you think you were angry up at that point?
I became rebellious.
Yeah.
What'd that look like?
Did you have to move cities or schools or anything like that? Or would you get to stay in the same area? You just had to move houses? Or
probably,
what'd that look like?
No, we just had to, like, move districts probably.
I got you.
From Nickeltown, so that's like McAllister Square area, Greenville Tech area, to Whitehorse Road. So that's Flea Market.
Well, that's
so
a
you
good
changed one. Schools, giving though.
Yeah, yeah, I changed
okay,
schools
gotcha.
And all, man.
Yeah,
I changed schools and all. So I was going to Beck Middle. So I had to go to Tanglewood Middle now.
Yeah.
So now I'm in Tanglewood, you know. And I'm new on the scene, and they slow. You feel me? They slow, bro. You know what I mean? I'm you know where I'm from, bro.
Yeah,
you know what I mean?
Yeah.
So I come and it's like Tupac on juice. Word.
Oh yeah.
I come and I'm like, yo, what we doing, man? You know what I mean? Like, you know, because by that time I know what weed is. You know, I know what weed is. I know what these things is, even though I haven't really, because I was just 13, y'all. I wasn't smoking weed at 13.
Yeah.
I didn't start smoking weed till like 16, 17 years old, you know, but I had to soaked up a lot of game. I knew how to shoot craps. I knew how to sell dope.
Yeah.
You know what I mean? I knew how to bag them up and cut them. I cut it, you know what I'm saying? I knew how to weigh it up.
Yeah.
I knew it was 28 grams an ounce, you know, 36 holes in a key. I knew these things, you know, I knew the math of it. I knew the game, you know, so when I came, they were slow, bro. They were slow.
They hadn't been exposed
no,
to that.
No, they haven't. Not kids that was my age.
Yeah.
Not yet.
Not yet.
Yeah, until Al got in the house.
Not yet. You know what I'm saying? And not only that,
so
but...
So those your first disciples?
In that sense.
Yeah,
in
no
that
doubt.
Sense, but I was wild, bro. But I was wild. So I adapted. But see, check this out. You said how that looked. So now check this out, y'all. Y'all, listen to me. Listen to me what I tell you. So I'm leaving the hood. I'm leaving somewhere where I had minimal restriction because by that time my grandma knew how to handle myself. You know what I mean? So while my cousins, they was girls, while they had to come in at a certain time and stuff with the streetlight come on, my grandma, I would come in a little later and my grandma wouldn't even trip, you know. But I'm 11, 12, 13 years old doing this. My cousins looking at me like, why he ain't, you know what I'm saying, getting yelled at and stuff like that. I mean, but y'all girls, it's different.
Right.
My grandma old school, you know, he a boy. You know, they know him. They know him out here. They know all of us. So if anything out there gonna do something to him, it's gonna strengthen him. You know what I mean? Because they gonna take care of him. They know him. She knew they knew me. Little Al Lucky son, you know. So you know, now I'm moving into a home with a stepfather that's Muslim. I'm moving into a home.
This is your mama's boyfriend.
No, husband.
Husband.
They married.
They married. They married. He Muslim.
And so Tanglewood was suburb or? It wasn't
like,
a hood.
It wasn't no hood. Not to me. Not
what
to
you
me.
Were used
yeah,
to.
Uh-uh.
It's just a court. Like, wouldn't we agree that's a little bit of a culture shock?
So is he practicing Muslim?
Yeah, yeah. So he's practicing Islam. He just did time at Rikers Island in New York. He's from New York. He's from Brooklyn, New York. You know what I mean? So he did like 10, 11 years on Rikers. Like, from what I was told. Well, he had books and all kind of stuff. I done seen all kind of stuff that he's done in prison and stuff like that. So he somehow merged down to Greenville, South Carolina, met my mom. Now... My mom, and I didn't know this until my mom's whole testimony, and I don't think my mom would mind me telling this aspect of it, but they originally connected on some pimp type.
Yeah.
You know what I'm saying?
Yeah, for sure.
So, you know, because my mom, you know, she was on drugs.
Yeah.
You know what I'm saying? So their relationship was, I'm going to you know, put you out here. You go out there and you get that money, man, yeah. to bring it back. Mm-hmm. But you know, it's some other stuff that was involved with it. But anyway, yeah. I'm going to leave that alone. But eventually end up getting married, you know, having children. So when I come in, I think my brother Ali and Omar might have been born. Matter of fact, Ali was born for sure. And Omar, she was pregnant probably with Omar when she regained custody of me. Then she had Lena, and then she had Latif. She didn't just regain custody. My mama the goat, really. You know what I mean? She just had an Achilles heel, and mm-hmm. it was crack cocaine.
Yeah.
She the goat, really. You know what I'm saying? She not only regained custody of me, but my two younger brothers that she left in the hospital because she was addicted to crack cocaine. She regained custody of Jonathan and Joseph, too. Mm. So now it's seven of us.
Wow.
You know, at the end, it all boiled out to be seven over those years. Well, I'm fast forwarding. Let me slow down a little bit. So Omar, pregnant with Omar. So now it's me, Jonathan, Joseph, Ali, and pregnant with Omar. Me, Jonathan, Joseph, Ali, and pregnant with Omar. So that's going to be five in the house. So Lena and Latif, they're going to come a little later. But within that time, you know, I'm Tanglewood High School, Tanglewood Middle School. Got to a point, I started working at Capri's Italian restaurant. And I was like 14. I was like 14. Like, when as soon as I got there, I got a job.
That's my spot, though.
Yeah, Capri's Italian restaurant. It was on Stone Ave. It was on Stone Ave back in the day. Yeah. But as soon as I got there, I got a job. Boom. I've always kept a job. I've always been a hustler, a worker. You know, and my step-pop, he would take me back and forth to work sometimes. Me and him, we built a rapport after a while. But that was after a while. After a couple slaps, after a couple fights, after a couple me running away, man. I hit man, I walked all the way to Nickeltown, bro. I walked all the way back. Just to have my mama come back over there with the minivan to pick me up and take me back. You know what I'm saying? But I ran away, man. It was a lot of things that happened that led to me running away. Boom, we building this thing, man. We building this thing. Everything it looks lovely. There's no pork in the house. You better not have no pork in this house.
Yeah.
You know what I'm saying? He ate avocado and cheese sandwiches on wheat bread, rye bread. You know what I'm saying? He was very strict. He made his own wine. Out of muscadines, you know what I'm saying, and he would just let it ferment.
Did y'all go to the mosque?
No, okay. We didn't. We didn't have to do it. We didn't
did he
do
go
it.
Though?
I'm not sure.
I got you.
Because he would be in. He hauled pallets for a living. He had this pickup truck. It was like five colors. The right side was red. The other side was green. The hood was blue. Yeah. You know what I'm saying?
No doubt.
But he would haul pallets on the back of it, bro. And he would stack them so high. He would build his own, and then he would go sell them to like Winn-Dixie, Bilo, distribute. You know, stuff like that. But he didn't work for. He had a thing. I'm not working for nobody. I'm not working for the man.
Yeah.
You know. So he just. That's how he got his money. You know. But he took care of. He took care of all of us. You know, he really did, man. That was my step-pops, man. And I gained to have this respect and this love for him after a while. But anyway, my mother relapsed. That's what I wanted to get to. My mother relapsed. And it was ugly. It was ugly. By this time, all of us are born. All of us. We're here. There's seven kids in the house. And all I remember, man, is them screaming, hollering. And I ran from the back. My back room, and by the time I got into the living room, the door was slamming. My mom was on the other side, and her finger was in the house. Mm. One of her fingers was in the house. And my step-pop had closed the door on her finger. Mm. And so I rushed over and opened the door, and you know what I'm saying? And it was like dangling, bro. Mm. It was like dangling, bro. It was like dangling. And she took off. Come to find out, he didn't want her to leave, but she wanted to go get high.
Yeah.
But he didn't want her to leave. And she wanted to leave, so, you know, get out. You know, get out. You know, but that's the relationship that started. Think about how that relationship started. What did you think? What did you expect?
Right.
You know what I'm saying? What kind of chaos did you expect was gonna come into this house? What kind of demons did you expect was gonna resurrect, bro?
Yeah. Right.
You know what I'm saying? These are spirits.
Yeah.
And they wasn't dead, bro.
No, they wasn't.
But they came back.
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
You know what I'm saying? So my mother ran away, and she'll be gone by 2 weeks. You know, now we don't know what she's doing. And within that time she's gone, now I got the minivan, the caravan. Now I'm hauling my brothers and my sisters to school because they in middle school. I'm in high school. You know what I'm saying? They're in middle school and elementary, you know, because it's seven of us. So I'm taking them to school, boom. One drop off, boom. Another drop off in the middle school, boom. And then I go to school. Mm-hmm. I'm plaiting my sister hair. You know what I'm saying?
Yeah.
And one of my brothers, Omar, he had long hair too, so I would plait his.
Mm.
You know what I'm saying? I would take the role of my mother. You know what I'm saying? I would do these things for my siblings.
Yeah.
I had to do that.
Yeah.
You know, and I was just a kid myself. I mean, really, I was a kid myself. I was in high school, you know, right. But I was working and everything like that too. You know, and we survived, bro. We survived, and she came back. She came back dirty, stinky, nasty, and she got clean. She got clean. Boom. We doing good, man. Okay, everything good. She relapsed again. Boom. And by this time,
how long of periods would she stay sober? Weeks, months, years?
I say years, bro. Okay. I say years.
I just want
to
follow.
I say about a year. There was a period where she relapsed back to back, and it was like in between like a year and a half, 2 years.
I got you. Okay.
You know what I'm saying? By this time, my step pops, his health is failing. Feeling bad, bro. He had a heart condition. Hmm. And he had surgery. He had heart surgery. What time is it, y'all? I need a time check.
You good. 7:55.
Okay. So he had heart issues. He had a heart surgery, a chest surgery. We went to see him. He was in a bed laughing, giggling, man. We was having a good time after his surgery, you know. Next day he died.
Mm. Dang.
He died. My mom, she was clean. You know, we get home, you know, of course, I can imagine her trying to put things together, keep things together with us, man. Me, I don't know what's finna happen. I really don't, bro.
How old were you at that time?
When my step pops passed, yeah. I was probably 17, 18.
Gotcha. Still in school.
I was probably 17, 18, about to graduate. Okay. Probably going through that whole phase.
Yeah, yeah.
Graduating, I'm feeling good, bro. Yeah. I got a job.
I've been working for something.
Yeah, man.
Yeah, I made it, bro.
Yeah, we made it.
Yeah, we made it. Yeah, we made it.
I graduated
can't
high
tell
school.
Me
even through that, you yeah. know what I'm saying? But my step pops was doing bad.
And this is at a point where you and him have built a rapport.
I'm calling
you
him
love
Pop
him.
Now, bro.
Yeah, 100%.
You know?
Well, he's been handling business.
Yeah, he has been. He really has been. Yeah. And for some reason, he wanted to try weed, like, closer to his death. You know what I'm saying? Like, this was before he had the surgery or whatever. And I ain't understand this until later. And I'm like, man, it's ironic how, you know, just out of nowhere, he wanted me to start getting weed and stuff like that. You know, because I was selling weed a little bit, too. You know, matter of fact, my mom, she met this dude, some plug, man, and he had the weed, man. So he would give us, you know, he would roll it. It was crazy. It was different. It was different how he would, you know, present it and give it to us, man. You know what I mean? It was just wild. I never seen it done like that before. We just, you know, tied a bag. He got them rolled up in bags, you know what I'm saying? Like neatly and all kind of stuff. But anyway, so my step pops, he would ask me, you know, hey man, go get me some weed. All right, pop. And I knew, you know, he kept his little brandy on top of the entertainment system with the TV at or whatever.
That's E&J, right?
Yeah, the E&J. Yeah, yeah. He kept that up there. And sometimes I would, you know, go sip.
Go take a little sip.
Yeah, he knew though. You know what I'm saying? It wasn't nothing too. But the wine didn't satisfy him no more. Mm-hmm. So now that I think about it, I'm thinking like something was happening. Something was happening internally in him.
Yeah.
To make him wanna search other stuff.
Yeah.
Cause all of a sudden this ain't doing it no more.
Yeah.
And this ain't doing it no more.
Yeah.
So now I gotta, you know what I'm saying?
The progression.
And yeah. The progression of something. So yeah. So yeah, he passed. He passed, man. And when my mom relapsed that last time, bro.
So did she relapse after he passed again?
No, matter of fact, yeah, she did. She She relapsed because she was clean when he passed, but she relapsed after he passed, and that's when we all got separated because nobody was there to keep us together.
Mm.
But when he passed, you know, I hated, but I left because I'm getting older now.
Yeah,
I graduated high school. I met this girl, you know what I'm saying? And even to this day, I believe my brother Jonathan, he may resent me for it, you know, because I left him.
Mm.
And he would tell me like, bro, you left us. It's times when my brother get real. And that's one thing about Jonathan, my brother Jonathan, man. And it doesn't matter who he around. It doesn't matter who you are. You know, he owns his pain, his struggles, his experiences. He was the one who was in them foster homes and they was burning his legs with cigarettes and stuff mm-hmm. like that. Him and Joseph. You know what I'm saying? He was the one who went through all that hell. You know what I mean? He probably experienced a rougher childhood than I did, because I had a grandmother that loved me, mm-hmm. you know, and did what she could. He grew up in a foster system, him and Joseph.
That's not the same.
You know what I'm saying? So Jonathan and Joseph, you know, Joseph, he's more vibrant, though. You know what I'm saying? Joseph, man, he's more optimistic. Mm-hmm. Joe is the one that's more likely to say, man, nah, I'm going to do it.
Yeah.
And I'm going to do it and watch this. Watch me do it and get out there and do it.
Yeah.
You know what I'm saying? But and Jonathan, he will too. He'll go get a two. But at the same time, Jonathan is a realist. You know what I'm saying? And he'll it comes to times where he going to tell you what's on his mind. You know what I mean? And whatever happened, you know? And it was a period where I left them. I left my brothers with my mom there. And this is after my step-pops passed.
Yeah.
But within that time, I became addicted to cocaine. Mm. Jonathan don't know that. That was around the same time I was addicted to cocaine.
Yeah.
You know, my mother would come into the room and see the plate. I probably contributed to her relapse, because she would see the plate of cocaine under the bed. Or not under the bed, hidden somewhere. I would have it hidden. And it was just, you know, something for me. You know what I'm saying? I wasn't selling it. I was still selling weed, but I was sniffing cocaine. You know, met this girl, man, and that didn't help. You know, that kind of contributed to it, you know. Yeah, that kind of contributed to it, man.
Do you remember the first time you snorted?
Vaguely.
Yeah.
Vaguely, bro.
I'm just, you know, it always intrigues me how we make the jump.
Yeah.
You know, because a lot of us start drinking young, mm-hmm. and then we start smoking weed, and then next thing you know, we're snorting. I mean, I remember when I did, I was in the car with a bunch of guys, and they all snorting, and I was scared.
Mm-hmm.
And I was like, nah, I'm good.
Right.
But after they did it for an hour or so, finally, I was like, well, let me hit it.
Yeah.
And then it was off to the races. So anyway, I'm always intrigued by how we make that jump. Because cocaine is a big difference
it
from
is.
Weed.
It's a huge difference. From the way it's handled, from the way that it's
and
your
its addictiveness,
intake.
Yeah, and how you take it in, yeah.
And the charge,
definitely the charge.
I mean, you don't want to get caught with cocaine, man, bro. I'm telling you
definitely,
now.
Definitely,
so,
the charge.
So that's why I was curious of how you made that jump. You know.
Yeah. So, and honestly, bro, I believe that it may have been a female. It may have been this particular female that I was with at the time, because it was my birthday. I'll never forget it. And before this, I don't think I had tried sniffing cocaine. I've handled it, but I don't think I've tried sniffing it before this time.
Yeah.
So we're in her bedroom. She just got out the shower. I'm sitting on her bed, and it's my birthday. You know what I'm saying? I guess we finna go out and do some things, man. And she tossed something and hit me in the back, and then it falls on the bed. And I look behind me and pick it up, and it's a ball of cocaine. You know, I knew what it was. I'm
little
like,
Todd Bundle.
Yeah. Like an 8-ball. You know, I said, what's up? What's the? She's like, we having fun tonight. We're gonna have fun. I hadn't, you know what I'm saying? I hadn't did this. You know, I hadn't did this yet. And only if she knew that she was waking up a beast that was laying dormant. You know what I'm saying? And it was just laying there.
Yeah.
Because my mother and my father was dealing with this same monster.
Yeah.
The same monster, and it's generational.
Yeah.
And it's passed down to me. She didn't know that. Only if she knew what she was waking up, bro. Yeah. You know what I'm saying? Because some people are functional addicts.
Yeah.
Me?
Not
bro,
so much.
I'm giving up everything.
Yeah.
Everything.
We party different.
Absolutely.
I'm partying my home away, my relationships everything, away, my car
bro.
Away, my clothes. You
bro.
Can have my shoes.
Bro, everything, bro.
So here's the
truth. That's how I became homeless, bro.
Well, here's the truth, bro. Like, people are like, man, like, listen to what Al's been through. And I'm here to tell you, the pain ain't even started yet.
Mm-mm.
Because there's most people right now saying, I couldn't even have survived that. But from what I know through talking to you, the pain of what you were about to tell us is going to drop their jaw.
Yeah. That's why I said it'll be 7 in the morning, bro.
But let's highlight this, man. You start using cocaine, you get addicted to cocaine.
Yeah.
But just tell us some highlights over the next, how many more years from that point was it before you met Jesus?
Okay. So, I say, about 3 years after my, but see, that period where I first started cocaine to me meeting Jesus?
A long ways. Take us through those 3 years prior to meeting Jesus.
Okay, so.
Hit the highlights of the things.
And I've always had a notion of him.
Yeah.
You know what I mean? I've always knew, God. God's somewhere watching over all of us. You know what I'm saying?
Where did that come from? Did you have any influence as a child?
Well, my grandmother.
Okay.
Yeah, my grandmother. She was, even though she was elderly, so she didn't come, she would send me to church.
Mm-hmm. I got you.
You know?
That's good. Thank you, Grandma.
You know, yeah. Super Saturday, man. The buses would come through the hood.
Oh, they pick you up.
They come pick you
and
up.
And that was a great day, wasn't it?
That was a great day.
Yeah, we
it's
wanted
so
it.
Important, man. A lot of times when we do in children's ministry, we don't understand we're not going to be the ones to see the fruit.
Absolutely.
You know? You may never see
you
it.
May never,
it
yeah.
may be 25 years
but
later.
But there's a lot of people that
it gets planted.
As sowed seed in our life and Al's yeah. life that never get to see this.
Yeah. No,
they may not even be alive.
They probably
sure.
gone, bro.
They may not even be alive.
They probably yeah. gone. Yeah, they probably dead and gone, man. But I do thank God for those seeds that were planted mm-hmm. by those people who was not selfish.
Yes.
Yeah. You know what I mean? They didn't consider it robbery to come and minister to me, to come and see about me.
Yeah.
You know, so my grandmother, she when I was younger, she would send me off. She would send me off, and I would have fun. I still remember, man, I remember so many church events, you know, where we load up the bus, Reverend Golden, yeah. man, and then it went to Redemption with Ron Carpenter, man. That's why okay. I love him so much, man, because he showed me love.
Yeah.
Yeah.
He showed my hood love.
Yeah.
Yo, he did. You know, we was right there in the hood, Nickeltown, and they was right there yeah. every Saturday, bro, showing us love, pulling out the trailer on the back, throwing concerts in the court, man. You know what I'm saying? Not caring about the hood and what the hood loved them. Mm-hmm. You know what I mean? Because they gave us attention, man, and they showed us love, man. Mm-hmm. They came through and they fed us. You know what I'm saying? And stuff like that. So I really appreciate him. That's a love that others can't understand who's never been in my shoes.
Yeah,
but yeah, man. So that's why I developed that. Acknowledgement of God. I yeah. knew that there was a God, but as far as a relationship, that came later.
Mm-hmm.
You know what I'm saying? That came way later because it takes pain to build relationships.
Mm-hmm.
You hear me?
Yeah.
You hear me?
Yeah.
You can't say you love someone if you haven't experienced them in their painful moments, in the moments to where they're their weakest.
Yeah.
You know what I'm saying? Or the moments where they're most aggravating, that they're the most hard to be around.
Yeah.
You can't say you love somebody if you ain't seen them
yeah.
in that form
yeah.
and still stayed.
Yeah. Yeah.
That's good.
Yeah.
You see what I'm saying?
Yeah, absolutely.
And it's real. Love has to be tested.
Yeah, it does.
Love has to be tested just like gold.
Yeah.
It has to be purified.
Mm-hmm.
There are steps and levels to love.
Yeah.
You know, and I had to learn that because the people that said they loved me, it goes back to that question, did they really love me?
Yeah. That's what I'm thinking of as you're experiencing this other love now. Of people who are coming in.
Hey, but listen.
You know?
The love of Jesus, though.
Yeah.
The
amen.
The love of Jesus.
Yeah.
Yeah.
You know? Because he doesn't bury me in my sins. He doesn't leave me at my faults.
Mm-hmm.
You know what I'm saying? He doesn't give me what I deserve, bro. Mm-hmm.
He stays closer than a brother.
Way closer than a brother. I'm getting chills, boy. I'm getting chills, Bradley. Don't do it.
Yeah.
I'm getting chills, man. I'm excited, man, because I made a post, man. I said, I know what the presence of God feels like. And I believe that that's the most important thing in the world right now.
Yeah.
Because even in the Bible, you've had important men of God who were in an atmosphere with God and did not know he was there.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. Many.
Mm.
Saul.
Mm.
So
we talk, many. We talk about Saul
so
all the
many.
Time.
Jacob. Think about Samson. He went to use his strength, didn't even know he didn't have it. No, didn't even know it wasn't on his life no more. Didn't even know he didn't hold it no more.
Yeah. Saul, same way, fired and
and then continued to
kept
operate.
Kept working.
Yeah.
No anointing.
Come on. Come on, bro.
But we are living a life to where we don't look at their life and say, we justify our mistake. We don't want to follow their footsteps, man.
No.
Right?
No, bro.
We want to overcome.
Yeah.
Right? But you paid a high price to be where you're at. Like,
yeah,
what,
so
you
hear
give,
that. Let's hear
like
that.
What you
I
giving
hear
these people right now for free, you paid a high price for.
Yeah.
Because you almost died.
Yeah, yeah.
Didn't you?
Yeah. Yeah, I almost died. My mom almost died. I almost died. It was just some stuff, man. It was just stuff that we were involved in. And it was just the way we were raised, man. We were headed in that direction and with no blinkers, no warning signs, no beware signs, nothing like that, bro, because we were so engulfed in the way that we were living.
Yeah.
And we thought that it was normal. This is just how we live, man.
Yeah.
You know what I'm saying?
Yeah.
Hustling, bustling, trying to eat, trying to feed a habit, a monkey on my back that's way bigger than I am.
Mm.
And I can't feed it.
Yeah.
I can't. It's not enough in the world to feed it. It's not enough time in a day to feed it.
Yeah.
You know what I'm saying? So I'm continue chasing. I'm continue running. Man, listen, there's been times, man, when I became addicted to crack cocaine, where I would walk the street from hood to hood. I don't care. Take me anywhere. I'll find a dope spot. I'll find a dope spot. And I know how to wiggle into it and get what I need. Mm. You know what I'm saying? Or I know how to go pick something up that's worth value, man, and come back to the dope man and say, listen, let me get something for this.
Yeah.
So tell me, how'd you make that jump?
From powder to cocaine.
When you go from powder to crack.
Bro, I mean,
like, this is important.
Oh, it is important.
You know, it's important for people to hear this, because nobody in, you know, seventh grade is thinking, one day I'm going to be snorting cocaine. And then nobody's thinking, one day I'm going to be smoking crack. But somehow or another, people continuously get there. And so if we can understand the process of it, maybe we can help some people not get there.
Yeah.
So tell us how you made that transition over.
I'm gonna tell you something, and I want all the young people to hear this, man. A boring life is a good life.
That's good.
A boring life, and I'm not just saying a boring life, y'all. A well thought out life, a well strategized life, a careful life. You know, because I just thought I was having fun. That's it. I just thought I was trying to feel good, not knowing that I was building a tolerance for something that was not of man.
Yeah.
It was not supposed to be for me.
Right.
Well, and let's be honest, bro. Like, all it takes is I show up one day and homeboy ain't got no powder.
And you're building.
Bro. Well, that's what happened to me. Yeah. Hey, dog. Bro. I mean, I want cocaine. Well, hey, dog. I ain't got no powder, but I do have this rock.
Right. And you built the tolerance, like he's saying. You may have been snorting all day.
Yeah, and you snort so much you can't even get it in your nose. It's just falling out your nose.
Exactly. And the next thing you know, there's another way to get it.
Boy, you taking me back, because I remember the day I went to over here on Whitehall Road to get some cocaine. Homeboy didn't have any, had crack. And you think I'm leaving there without cocaine?
Right. Exactly.
No.
And that's what I'm talking about.
I borrowed a 40. Yep. I went back to the house. I put some holes in a can. I took two Bic lighters and I smoked crack. And I'm going to tell you right now, the reason why I kept smoking, because it was better than anything I'd done up to that point. And I'm going to tell you, it instantly had me.
Yeah.
By my neck.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. Me too. It was scary. The most scariest feeling in the world, man. Because it was like I was on a train. And I was going full speed. And the track was about to end. And I ain't got no brakes. Mm. I ain't got no brakes. And the track is about to end and it's coming up. And I ain't got no brakes, bro. Mm. Because no matter what, I would tell myself, I ain't getting high today. Oh, I ain't going to get high today. Mm. I'm not going to do nothing today. I ain't going to do it. And I barely had a home to live in, bro. I was living with my aunt at the time. Bless her soul, man. Rest in peace to her. Angela Brown. My aunt Angel. I was living with her at the time and my uncle. We was staying right there at Angel House. And, you know, I barely had a home. You know, she allowed me to stay because that was my big mom house. That was the house that I was raised, born. I mean, not born, but I was raised in that house. My grandma raised me in that house. And now I'm older, smoking crack in the house.
Mm. Your grandma's passed away at this point.
My grandma's passed away at this point. And now I'm smoking crack in the house, same house that I was raised in, bro. Mm-hmm. You know? And I'm feeling, and I'm not even in the space. I'm not even in the space to have any remorse. I'm not even in the space to feel bad for what I'm doing. Mm. And that's the thing, bro. Because I want to get high so bad. Nothing else mattered.
Nothing.
Nothing else mattered, bro. You know, rest in peace to my aunt Angel, man. You know, bless her soul, because she has so much patience with me. She has so much patience with me, man. Yeah. You know, I mean, bro, I could tell you some things. I could tell you some things. What you want to know? But you know, the transition from weed to powder and powder to crack cocaine, was fun. It, it, It was me thinking that that was fun. I got with this girl, we sniffing powder, we up all night sometimes. I'm not sleeping, and so now I'm developing this tolerance, this habit for cocaine. I gotta have it. We're going from home to home to people with people who do the same thing we do. We might crash on their couch and stuff like that. So I was homeless before I was homeless, y'all. Yeah, you know, right. I seen myself building up to this life of nothing. Mm. You know what I'm saying? So it got to the point. Well, now I'm in Fieldcrest. I'm young. I'm young, bro. I'm probably like 19, 20 years old, man. And I call myself trying to sell crack. Now I sell weed. I used to sell weed. I was selling weed in high school when I was coming up. And now because all my family, everybody in my family, man, that's all I seen, bro. That's all I knew was the crack, was the game. That's it. Either they did it or they sold it. And if they sold it, they sold it.
Oh yeah. Yeah.
I got cousins and auntie that has so much money. That done has so much money. You know what I'm saying? And I'm seeing this. But somebody gotta be the addict. Somebody gotta be the addict. Everybody right. can't sell it. Somebody gotta be the addict. So right. so yeah, I fell on that sword. Yeah. Me and my mom and my uncle, some of my uncles too. Like my whole family, we was involved with the drug type thing, man. So now I call myself trying to sell crack, and I'm in the hood. 3 o'clock, 4 o'clock in the morning. I'm sniffing at the time. I'm sniffing too, and that's the worst thing you could ever do. Try call yourself a dope dealer, and you sniffing powder, you sniffing cocaine.
Don't work.
It's only a matter of time, bro. It's only a matter of time. As a matter of fact, you call yourself a drug dealer, you do drugs. Ain't no such thing. It's only a matter of time, man.
Yeah.
Don't play yourself like that. You know? Find a trade. Drive trucks. Do something.
Really, it's sowing and reaping.
Absolutely. Absolutely. Yeah, and I believe that because so many people that were doing good selling drugs, kingpins back in the day, they either addicts now or they're working a mediocre job.
Or they in prison.
Yeah. You know what I'm saying?
Or dead.
It is. There's no glory in it.
Yeah. So what you doing at 3 in the morning? Sniffing powder.
Yeah, I'm trying to sell crack. I'm in a crack spot. I'm in a crack spot. And dude, he know who he is. I ain't gonna say his name, you know. But he was the runner for me at the time. I'm not saying I was a big. I wasn't selling no big boy dope or nothing like that. But he was running for me that night. You know what I'm saying? And he was getting these rocks off that I had. You know what I'm saying? And he was bringing that money back. You know, I ran out of powder. I called a dude. Like, yo, I'm over here such and such, such. Bro, I'm out. Same scenario, but it was introduced to me by my runner. Mm-hmm. He say, I said, man, because I'm jonesing. Man, I'm finna just call it a night, I guess. I can't call it no night, bro. Bro, I'm wired.
Yeah, there's no calling
ain't
it a night.
Ain't no calling it no night. Everybody know that who's ever really been an addict, man. Ain't no calling no night. You know, so he said, you got the next best thing right there, man. You know, you just do a little sum of it, man. I'm telling you. So he basically persuaded me into doing it. You know.
Was he doing it already?
He was doing it already. So yeah, because he was an addict. Yeah,
that's why he was running.
Absolutely.
Yeah.
Because he's stomping everything he's selling.
Yeah. And they would so, do it. And they would, yeah. You know he's breaking it.
Oh,
yeah.
And
yeah.
So now he's saying, if I can get you to smoke with me.
Oh, he jet.
You already know.
I'm not thinking. I'm not even thinking, bro.
No reasoning.
Yeah. I'm not even thinking, man. But he had the plan the whole time. Oh, we finna have a party.
Oh, yeah.
Oh, we finna have a party. I'm finna get the rest of that bag right there. That's what he's saying the whole time to me. You know, because once I get him to, boy, listen, that. Drugs in general, but crack, man, it's a walking demon.
It's a walking demon, man,
and you can't see it, but when you're in its vicinity, and you got people that's in its vicinity, it's gonna try to find its way to you some kind of way, man.
Yeah, there's no doubt.
Some kind of way, bro. Crack, bro. It done took over so many. You know what I mean? Probably not today, 2024. You know, but. You know, back in the day, man, listen, I've seen so many fall victim to it. I fell victim to it. My aunts, my mother, my father, I mean, my uncles, all of us, we fell victim to crack cocaine. All of us, man. You know, it's a beast, man, that has to be silenced. It has to be killed.
So what was that turning point?
Yeah, how'd you get out?
How'd you get out of that?
Turning point.
You went to turning point.
Yes.
Nice.
So, but that was later. So, man, but it's so much within that time when I was getting high. it's so much within that time when I was, I'm talking about robbing dope boys. I'm talking about robbing people, whatever. Matter of fact, I don't want to, you know, say a lot of too much stuff, but it was a lot that went on within that time of my addiction, you know, with my addiction, man. I was a roamer. I just roamed.
So what eventually...
Looking for familiar spirits.
Mm-hmm. So what eventually caused you to want to stop? Because everybody who stops first has a desire to want to stop.
Yeah, man.
So what caused you to get to the point where you had had enough? Because you say, you know, when the runner came back, you didn't have the wherewithal to say, I don't want to do that. But there's some moment of clarity that we all have where something shifts.
Yeah.
And we're like, this got to change. Like, what happened?
I think I had a few of those moments, though. Uh-huh. I had a few of those moments, but none of them was ever successful. For real, I was wanting to stop. I didn't want to live
until
like that.
Until the last one, though, eventually.
Until eventually. Now, the very last time I said, you know, I was at a gas station. My mother had been shot 14 times by this time. Mm. My mother had been shot 14 times, and she's trying to recover. She survived 14 shots. And she's trying to recover. Me, I'm at this gas station, strung out. This is probably my third, fourth day up. I'm hungry. Ain't got nowhere to go. It's cold. So I called my mom. I asked, I used the phone there, I guess. I called my mom and she like, baby, you know, I'm trying to recover. You know, ain't too much I can do right now. I'm trying to recover myself. She said, call the ambulance. And she said, let them know how you feel. Mm. She said, let them know exactly how you feel in the condition that you're in. So I called the ambulance, and they came and got me. And they put me in an annex. They took me to Greenville Memorial. It's an extension of Greenville Memorial. It's called the annex. And this is where people who are paranoid, schizophrenic, who are delusional, who are borderline psychotic, suicidal,
yeah.
Take pills, run through screaming all day.
It's a psych ward.
Yeah.
So I was there. They took me there. And I stayed there for about a week. And I would see so much. It was scary. But I knew I had to do this. Mm. I knew I had to do it. So after a week or two, she came to me. One of the ladies, the nurses there, because I wasn't a paying patient. So she came to me. She said, Are you ready to get back out there? You know, you think you're ready to go? Because they're going to need the bed I'm in. You know what I'm saying? They're going to need my space. They got people that pay to do this. I said, no. I said, they'll kill me. I'll die. I said, I'll die out there.
Mm.
And she said, okay. She said, let me see what I could do. She made a few phone calls. From the annex, I went to the Phoenix Center.
Shout out to the Phoenix Center. Still helping people. Shout out Detox in Greenville.
Absolutely.
Yeah.
Shout out to the Phoenix Center. I went to the Phoenix Center, same scenario. I was craving sweets, chocolate, and stuff like that. So I would eat good. You know, they provided me with room and board in there for a while. Same scenario. It was about 2 weeks, 2.5 weeks. They asked me the same question, Bradley. They said, you ready to go? You know, because once again, I'm not paying. They need that space. I told her the same thing. I'm not ready. I'll die. I will die. And I'm starting to feel pretty good. You know, I don't want to go back out there. I don't want to go back out there. And I didn't. She said, okay, let me see. She called Turning Point. Turning Point right there on Frontage Road, right there off
80. White Horse Road.
Yeah. Yeah, right off White Horse Road.
So like an old motel.
Yes, mm-hmm. That's exactly what it is. So I got into Turning Point. They got me a job at Forcia, making car parts for BMW. I'm working, meeting people, starting to feel normal. You know what I'm saying? Starting to feel good. You know, they provide me room and board, and they had dry pantry with dry foods and gently used items that you could wear, clothing and stuff. They take you back and forth to work, you know, as long as you just pay room and board or whatever like that. I could have visits. My mom come and see me, you know. My mom she's healing up real good. They had a basketball goal. She out there playing basketball after being shot 14 times. it was God's glory the whole time. Mm-hmm. It was God's glory. I seen God's glory so many times in my life. I seen his glory. I seen him telling me, I got you. Not only that, but I have something for you, a plan for you. Mm-hmm. I have an expected end for you. And pain is not part of it. You know? So, turning point. We on holidays we get to go, you know, and visit family and stuff like that. So it was Christmas came around. And I went at this time they was boarding up the old hood that I'm from, Fieldcrest. Jesse Jackson. They was boarding it up. But my mom's apartment was one of the last ones there. It was only like a handful of apartments that was still left in that community, mm-hmm. that hood, you know, because everything was getting boarded up. They finna tear these down and build and rebuild. So, but my mom was one of the handful that was still there. So I said, I'm going to see my mom. That's when I learned that spirits are territorial. It was something about that territory.
Yeah,
because you can cast it off a person, but if you don't cast it out of the region, the territory,
region,
it'll get region. Back on somebody.
But yeah, that's how they
that's
operate.
That's a Jezebel spirit right
that's
there.
That's how they operate. They operate in regions. Mm-hmm. It's a lot of spirits that operate in regions. You know, some areas are way worse than others. You know, and that because of the spirit that's being fed in that area. You know what I'm saying? So even though, you know, I'm clean and I go back out here in this hood, you know, you still got a few guys out there and they still selling dope because people know that's still the spot to come through. Even though it's boarded up and everything, right. That's just a better spot to hustle at now, but not really, because the police watching it now.
Yeah.
They know, you know what I mean? Because that's the only way. They had to tear our hood down. Our hood was a $1 million spot, bro. Mm. And you ask anybody about Fieldcrest. Nickeltown, and you know what I'm saying? Back in the early 2000s or late 90s, you know what I'm saying? Before they tore it down, $1 million spot. The only way was to tear it down.
Yeah.
That was the only way, bro, and disperse people.
Yeah.
You know, because man,
Which
happens a lot.
Yeah.
But yeah, so they still selling dope out there and stuff like that. But me, I'm going home for the holiday, for Christmas. You know what I'm saying? And I just want to be with my mom. You know what I'm saying? I'm mingling with the guys out there, man. And, you know, some of them happy to see me, some of them ain't. Because they know I wreak havoc. I wreaked havoc in the hood. I had guys come up to me and say, bro, you making the hood hot. You got to go. they're like, man, you got to go. How you going to put me out my hood? I ain't going nowhere. This my hood, man. You know what I'm saying? But I was a little bitty something, too, getting high out there. You know, you can't put me out there. I was born and raised right here, bro. I'm not going nowhere, you know what I'm saying? But yeah, because the police was looking for me after I had to rob the Pumpers, you know, and then ran, shot back to the hood. I robbed the Pumpers on Pleasant Bird right there. It's now Sphinx. I robbed Dairy Queen. I robbed 2 Waffle House in one night. Gunpoint. You know? But I've been charged for all this, so you know what I'm saying? And I done time for it. They gave me 15 years in the penitentiary. I did 5.5 and I got out on parole. You know, so all of this is behind me now. This is my testimony.
Right.
You know, this is my testimony. And I believe that this testimony can help mold and frame the decisions of our youth.
Bro, I'm telling you right now, the people in the sound of our voice are changing because they're listening to this. Like, this ain't just a story he's telling. This is God's story. And so you go back to the hood. So I'm assuming at this juncture, you do relapse again after leaving Turning Point.
I do. But not with crack.
Not with crack.
With cocaine.
But where in the world in this story does Al stand face to face with the God of the universe?
I'm finna show you. We getting there. We making progress. So I go back to the hood. I'm kicking it with my mom. Blunts get rolled. I call myself hitting a blunt. Not knowing that when I go back to Turning Point,
they're going to drug test you.
Yeah.
You failed it.
I failed it. I had to tell my mom, like, Mom, I failed the drug test. She said, so, baby, I wanted you to come home. I wanted you here with me. And that just made me feel so much better. You know what I'm saying?
Yeah, for sure.
But, of course, that's mama. Sometimes, listen, my mama one of the mamas, man. My mama one of the mamas, man, that will speak up for her babies no matter if they baby's guilty or innocent. You know what I'm saying? Nah, that's my baby.
Yeah.
You know what I'm saying? My mama's one of the mamas wake up at 3-4 o'clock in the morning if her baby called. Like, ma, I'm out here at this club, they drinking, they fighting. You know, my mama coming, bro.
Yeah.
She done did it. Oh, my mama coming, man. You know what I'm saying? So my mama one of the mamas, she said, baby, listen, I wanted you home. I want you home. I said, all right, ma, that made it even better. So I went back home, and of course, needless to say, now I'm smoking weed heavy now. Now I can really smoke weed, you know. But not only weed, you know what I'm saying? It got to a point to where I done dibble dabbled again with cocaine.
Yeah.
So now I'm sniffing cocaine. We went from the boarded up old hood to Crossroads. Crossroads is right there in the backside of Greenville Tech, like you're going toward YMCA on Cleveland Street. On Cleveland Street. So we're at Crossroads. We got an apartment out there in Crossroads. I'm sniffing. I meet girls. I'm doing stuff. Man, listen, it was just wild. It was wild. I was falling back into it, bro. I was falling back into that life. You know, got with a couple guys, stick up kids. They knew who I was. I knew who they was. We from the same hood. Y'all, what's up? What's the move, man? What we gonna do? And that's when, you know what I'm saying, these two particular dudes I would go to rob with often. We would it's nights, Friday nights, Thursday nights, you know, every so often we would get in that car and strapped up,
do your thing,
and run up on something, whether it's somebody stumbling out the club late at night or whether it's an establishment we got to run up in, you know what I'm saying? And either or, you know, but we would do these things. We would rob at nights. This particular night, we pulled up at a Sphinx, and I told them, I said, man, I'm finna go do my thing. You know, they said, nah, man, not tonight. Not tonight, man. I said, what you mean not tonight, man? What I'm strapped for then? I said, all right. So I goes in, call myself buying some Black Miles and stuff like that. They ringing it up. I draw out on them. Back up. They back up quick. I hop the counter. Go in the register. Get everything that I can. I'm hopping back over the counter. I had money on me. So it was the thrill of it at this point. Mm-hmm. And I was skied out my mind with cocaine. Mm-hmm. You know, I was high on cocaine. You know, so I jumped back over the counter, heading out the door. I still got the pistol in my hand, y'all. You know what I'm saying? I'm in a frantic. I'm running out because my homies out here waiting on me, though I thought.
They gone.
As soon as the door opened, bro, I'm looking for them. They gone. So now they got me outside the Sphinx. I just robbed with the pistol in my hand, money stuffed out, you know, hanging out my pocket in my hand, and they gone. So what I do, I hit the side road, the frontage road, where Sarah Lee was, right there off White Horse Road, boom. That old frontage road, Sarah Lee, it was that Sphinx. They got a subway connected to it now, or whatnot. But anyway, no, I think they rebuilt it. But anyway, I hit the side road where the old Sarah Lee was, boom. I see headlights, you know, because I could see it's getting bright, so it's a car pulling. I look behind me, and I see how you could tell by the headlights what kind of car it is.
Yeah.
I look behind me, it was an SUV. So I wasn't kind of, you know, I was like, well, you know, it ain't the police. It's a Jeep or something like that. So I kind of slowed down a little bit, man. Mind you now, I still got the pistol in my pocket at this time and the money in my pocket. I'm slowing down a little bit. I heard brakes. I heard doors open. Next thing I heard, put your hands up. I look back. I see sheriff vests. You know what I'm saying? They in the unmarked SUV. Put your hands up. I turn around and I was had, bro. I was had. You know, I was planning on getting away, or else I would have threw the pistol. I wasn't finna throw my pistol. You know what I'm saying? Just that wasn't happening, bro. So I had the pistol and the money on me. You know, and they asked me. They said, you know, we got word that a Sphinx up the street. They said we got a call that a Sphinx was robbed. Do you know anything about that? I said it was me. I said it was me, cause I was guilty as charged. It was me, so they put me in the back, and this is weird. But as soon as I hit that back seat, I start shaking, like I'm having a seizure or something. You know what I'm saying? On purpose. I'm doing this on purpose though. Desperate. That's that spirit. I gave up. I was tired.
But it was something in me that still wanted to get out there. Get out there, get free, get high, live this life that's destined to kill me. You know what I'm saying? So I'm shaking like I'm epilepsy or something. And one of the officers said, "You think we should take him to the hospital?" That's what I wanted them to do. Take me to the hospital. Take me to the hospital. At least I got a chance, boy. Because if I get on my feet and I get in the woods,
it's gone.
What? Don't let me get close to my hood. It's really over. You know? Another one said, "Nah, his ass going to jail tonight." So yeah, they took me to jail. They took me to the county jail. And that was in June of 2006, 2007. And I didn't see the streets again.
When I got out.
I didn't see the streets again until 2012, September 5th. You know, I didn't see the streets again, bro. After that robbery right there, man, they left me at the store, man, and I got caught. Okay, I met Jesus, got into the county. I've been seeing God study the word. I got into it, but at the same time, my homies in here, we got Friday fight night, point your man out. You know what I'm saying? Point your man out. You got beef with somebody, point your man out Friday fight night. You know what I mean? I mean, really, it was like we getting wrecked. Because when you locked up and you build so much tension, you got to get it off some kind of way. Only real convicts know what wreck is. You know what I'm saying? Like, you got to fight. You got to get it off some kind of way. Working out ain't going to get it all the time. You know, you got to swing hands. Sometimes you got to get hit. You got to feel the hit. And then go in the lockup 23-1 for a minute. And then come back out. Okay, I'm calm now. I needed that. I needed that. You know what I mean? Because the pressure, the weight, is so intense. The bid, not knowing how much time you facing. You know, not being able to get to your loved ones, your family. Not being able to hold your kids, bro. You know what I'm saying? All that tension weighs on a man. Mm-hmm. Or his woman might be out there doing Lord knows what.
Yeah.
Especially something like that. Yeah, you know what I'm saying? Sure. That's why it's so important to know how to bid.
Mm-hmm.
You get locked up, you better know how to bid. I got two brothers that's bidding right now. One doing 12 years, one doing 10, Omar and Ali. And they call me all the time, man. You know, Omar just got into an altercation, man, to where they had to ship him to the medical ward in Columbia. You know, because Omar done been stabbed up and everything. My brother, my little brother, this is my baby brother. You know, well, not my baby, Latif, my baby brother, but these are my baby brothers. Mm-hmm. You know, Ali and Omar, these are the direct sons of my stepfather, the Muslim.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
Lonel Teasley. These are the direct sons to him. And these boys locked up right now, you know, wildin'. Mm. I mean, wildin'. In prison, wildin'. One got 12 and one got 10. And you know, they've been down for a while, about 7-8 years now though. So they'll be home soon. But anyway, my bidding. That's when I seen Jesus. That's when I seen Jesus. I was locked up in the county for 8 months. Finally went to trial. My lawyer, my attorney Chris Posey at the time, he said, "Listen, you jumped in the water this time." He said, "They're offering you 15 years. No. They're offering you 10 years, violent, armed robbery, possession of a weapon during commission of a violent crime, second degree burglary." I said 10 years. I said, "Listen, this is my first time being convicted. I done been in and out the county, but I ain't never been convicted of nothing. I ain't never been sent down the road. You know what I'm saying?" I said, "This is my first." I said, "Bro, you got to come with something better than that."
So that's a mandatory minimum in Georgia. Was good.
Listen, he left.
For armed robbery.
For armed robbery, right? Yeah, and it was. It was kind of, you know, that was expected. So he left, and he came back. He said, "Okay, they're considering since you're right. You know, you haven't been convicted of a crime before, you know, and this is your first time really being locked up, sent down the road." He said they negotiated with 15. I said, "What?"
Well, he went up.
Yeah. But 15-65. So it went from 85 to 65. It went from a violent to a nonviolent. Okay. So with this 15 years nonviolent, I'm eligible for parole.
Yeah.
Which the violent charge, you're not. I'm eligible to work on the streets if my custody level dropped low enough and my behavior is good. I could work on trash trucks and empty trash cans and buildings and stuff like that on the outside. And not only that, but the most I'll do out of that 15 nonviolent, what, 7.5-8 years, and that's unless I run it up. Now, if that 10-85, I would have ended up doing that whole thing.
Yeah.
You know what I'm saying? Basically, I would have probably ended up doing that whole, yeah, mm-hmm. 8.5, almost 9 years, yeah. Mm-hmm. I would end up doing that whole thing. So I felt like I, okay, bet. So I could get, so it's on me now. It's on me now. So I knew in my mind that I had to get in, I had to go to prison. I had to go to prison with a mindset of, I have to change. I can't stay like this. Because I didn't want to run my bid up, because I knew I could. I could end up doing that whole 15, really. Oh, yeah. You know what I'm saying? I didn't want
to. Or end up doing something where you can't get out.
Or can't get out, yeah. Because I've seen it. Because I've seen, I ain't seen so much blood in my life, bro. You know what I'm saying? So McCormick, boom, got sent down the road to McCormick. This was in 2008. Boom. As soon as I get into the bullpen or the dorm, man, I'm hearing guys kicking on the doors, man. They screaming, they yelling. We in the lunch line, man, and dudes jumping on COs, man, and rocking them too, knocking them out, bro. Officers, COs, man, you know what I'm saying? And they wild, the blood everywhere, man. You know these dudes, they're controlled by something or so much tension, man. You know what I'm saying? I don't know, but it's something that runs through these guys sometimes that's in prison, man. I done seen so much blood, and I done seen guys have no remorse, man. Walk around with phone books taped to them because they finna stab. You know what I mean? It's finna be an all out stab session. You know what I'm saying? I would see these things, man, and hear waking up in the morning. Guys upstairs sharpening blade, you know, sharpening their knives, their shanks. You know what I'm saying? When you hear that noise, you know what they doing, and you know what's finna go down. Yeah. You know, these are moments, man, that I did not understand, bro. I did not understand, but luckily my uncle, Bobby Kaufman, we called him OG. By the time I had got to McCormick, he had already did 13 years at McCormick. He was the OG on F4. Upstairs, I didn't know that was my uncle until one day on the basketball court we was out there wrecking, and he came sat back down beside me. He said, "What's your daddy name, boy?" I told him. I said, "Al Lucky." He said, "That's my brother-in-law. I'm married to his sister, Cordell." I said, "He said I'm your uncle." I said, "For real?"
Thank you, Lord.
Man, listen, bro. Listen, and there's so many things that went down. I gotta tell y'all this, man. Demetrius Pepper, shout out to Demetrius Pepper. That's my brother. We won a talent show at McCormick, first place. He sung and I rapped. That was my man. We came down together at McCormick, man. And I'm sure he won't mind me telling this story, but at this particular time in the penitentiary, now I'm seeking God though. I'm seeking God at this moment, and I'll go back to that if we have time. But Demetrius Pepper, he's the brother of Nathan Pepper. Nathan used to play for South Carolina Gamecocks. Nathan Pepper, his little brother Demetrius Pepper. Me and Demetrius Pepper got locked up together at a level 3 yard on McCormick. Now Demetrius Pepper, since that was my guy, he would always come to my cell every now and then. We would chop it up and stuff like that. Demetrius Pepper would always hang with this guy, Sharif. He was Muslim. Sharif was Muslim. Sharif was different, though. He was like real reserved, real, you know what I'm saying, I guess, pritzy. You know what I'm saying? So I didn't know, you know, I just knew they was close, you know what I'm saying? But Pep was my dog. Like I said, it was my dog. One time they got into an altercation. I don't know why. Pep came to my room. He was like, "Man, something finna go down." I said, "Pep, what you mean something finna go down?" He said, "Man, listen, I just busted Sharif in the face." Now listen. Sharif Muslim. Sharif got a community. And they serious, bro. This is true story, bro. True story. You know, he said, "I just busted Sharif in the face." I said, "What you mean?" He had blood all on his hands and all, man. I said, "Man, what you mean?" He said, "Bro, I don't know what to do." He was scared to death, y'all. Scared to death because he knew what could take place right now. An all-out war, bro. Because these boys ain't playing. This level 3 yard, man. You got people that live here. They know they ain't never going nowhere. This is their home. And they go fight for their home. You know what I'm saying? So anyway, he was scared to death. I said, "Come on." We went upstairs. I knocked on my Uncle OG door. I said, Unc. "Man, listen, Pep just got into something, man. I don't know what's really going on, but they talking about jumping on Pep, man. They talking about jumping on him." Unc said, "Calm down," because he seen that I was. They talking about jumping on Pep. Unc. He's like, calm down. He reached under his bed and got a lawnmower blade that had them been shaved, fouled into a, you know what I'm saying, like a machete or some type stuff. You know, for real, bro. He puts it down his pants. We walk down the steps. Like I said, he upstairs. We walk down the steps. The room where all the Muslims they was at. You know, gathering up, and my uncle knew it. He knew, you know, where they be at. So he went to the room, knocked on the door. They opened the door. It's guys all on the wall, top bunks. They sitting on the sink, on the toilet. They sitting everywhere. the whole wall, you can't even see the wall because it's guys and Muslims everywhere, right? So we walked into the room, and my uncle said, "What's going on?" You know, and I guess the guy, the imam that spoke up for him, you know, your boy transgressed. He transgressed first, you know, so it's only right. It's only right for that he get transgressed against. You know what I mean? And basically, so my uncle agreed to it. All right. He get one lick. The guy can get one lick. So when the guy swung at Pep, he barely tapped his chin. And then his brother said, "Boy, is that all you got? Is that all you got?" Because come to find out, he was homosexual, man. You know, I mean, you know, but that's what they do. You know, that's what they do. And I don't know the pressure that they under, man, and what caused people to do stuff like that. And I didn't know Pep was my best friend, bro. That was my man. And I didn't know. I did not know that he was involved with that. You know what I'm saying? That's why they was beefing. That's why they had them got into a, you know what I'm saying? Because he had threatened to expose them or something like that. Pep was like, "No." And then he bust him in the face. And this is how it all came. But the thing is, his community didn't know that he was like that either. Mm. You know what I mean? So he was immediately, you know what I mean? He was basically they exiled. You know what I'm saying? You out, man. You know what I'm saying? We ain't dealing with you. We marked you. You know what I'm saying? And he started writing suicide notes and stuff like that. They had to send him to suicide watch, long story short. But, you know, he got his lick, and that was it. You know what I'm saying? And my uncle said, "That's all he go get." And we turned around and we walked out, you know? And that's all it was after that, bro. Mm-hmm. You know what I'm saying? But it looked scary. They looked like wolves at first. You know what I'm saying? Oh, I said, "Boy, sure. I gotta go get my uncle, man." I said, "Come on, Pep." We went up, and that's exactly that's how that was resolved, bro. Mm. You know what I'm saying? He transgressed, so he transgressed back against him. He had a free shot, and he didn't do good, bro. He didn't do good at all, man. So yeah, man, we turned around and we walked out, and I had a talk with Pep. You know what I'm saying? He said, "Man, I'm sorry. You know, I'm sorry," because he blindsided me. And then I had to talk with my uncle. And my uncle said, "You stay away from Pep." He said, "I know Pep, your man, and I know y'all cool." He said, "But Pep is involved with other stuff. Pep had 3 life sentences. Pep got way more time than you got." Mm-hmm. You know what I'm saying? He said, "You stay away from Pep." I didn't know how to be it, but I was learning. I was learning, you know, and I thank my uncle for that, for holding my hand and walking me through that bid.
Yeah.
But anyway, Joseph Stokes, shout out Joe Stokes, man. We call him Poke Chop. And McCormick, I would see him with the Bible in his hand, walking around smiling, man. And I asked him one day, I said, "Man, how much time you got? I know I ain't supposed to ask, but how much time you got?" He said, "Man, I ain't never going home. This is my house. This is where I live." You know, I said, "Well, you know, from your countenance and your attitude, man, like you going home tomorrow." Mm. I said, I wanted that. It was attractive to
that's
me.
That's good.
I wanted that. He said, "Meet me at the prayer in Sherwin Wednesday night." So Wednesday came, I couldn't wait either. I remember I couldn't wait. I could not wait, because at this time now, I've been reading. My mother been sending me pamphlets in the mail. I've been reading. I've been studying up. Not only that, but I had been preaching. I had been preaching a little bit in the county with the guys. All of us was, really. But I hadn't really walked into my preaching yet. You know what I'm saying? I'm at McCormick now. So I go to the prayer and share that Wednesday night, man. And these guys, man, as soon as I walked in, I felt the love. Mm-hmm. They smiled ear to ear because it was a new face. You know what I mean? And they knew what building meant. They knew what strength in numbers meant. They knew that one can put 1,000 to flight and 2 can put 10,000. They knew these things, that they wanted to build a community of God-fearing men that can change something.
Yeah.
They wanted change, bro. Yeah.
And it was also their ministry, and they wanted souls.
Yeah, absolutely.
You know?
Absolutely.
But you got to think, this is where they're evangelizing.
Exactly.
Yeah.
And this is how, that's how they control things within the prison. Mm-hmm. You know what I'm saying? The right way, though. You know what I'm saying? Right. With love.
Yeah.
For each other. This is how we provided for each other.
Yeah.
People that didn't have money coming through in the mail. People that didn't get mail. You know what I mean? People that didn't get commissary and stuff. This is how this community is able to come together and provide for these people.
That's
you know
so
what
good.
I'm saying? And that was love. I loved it, man. These guys made me feel alive. That's when I knew. That's when I really knew, Bradley, that God had something for. I could have went Vice Lord GDs. I could have went Blood Crip. I could have went Muslim. I mean, I could have went anywhere, bro. But I decided to stick with Jesus. Mm. I said, "I want Jesus." Because this whole time, when my mother was shot 14 times and she survived, it was Jesus. Mm. When I was homeless on the street, what kept me covered, even though I was hellacious out there, it was Jesus, bro. Yeah. That was Jesus that kept me. When I was shot at the hotel by my homeboy, and he could have shot me and killed me right there, bro, that was Jesus. Matter of fact, That man that said he was in the military that I met after I got shot, and he took me to his room next door in Town Suite, ran water on my wound and kind of nursed my wound. That was Jesus. Mm. That was Jesus, bro.
Why are you preaching?
You know what I mean? And I seen him. I seen Jesus in many occasions. But most of the time, it was when I was in pain, bro.
Yeah.
Present help in a time of trouble.
Yeah, he kept showing up.
Come on, somebody.
Mm-hmm. Most of the time, I was in pain when I seen Jesus. But I seen him nevertheless. And every time he would tell me, you ain't going nowhere, boy. You ain't going nowhere. I'm not letting you go nowhere. Mm. But because I can use you. Mm. I could use you in this time right here.
That's so good.
I seen Jesus, bro. So when I got to prison and I seen them guys smiling, I seen what they had. I said, oh, I know what you wanted, Jesus. I know what it was that you were trying to get me to see the whole time now. Mm. It was a feeling, a connection. It was a bond, a relationship. It wasn't religion, bro.
Yeah.
It wasn't religion. It's still not. It was a relationship with me. Mm. Jesus introduced himself to me in a different atmosphere. You can't expect me to have a relationship like the man that went to 3 years seminary and born, raised up in a church and you know.
You don't.
Who know Greek, Hebrew and Greek backwards and forward. Bro, listen, I respect that and I love it and I would like to have that knowledge. I would. But God presented himself to me different, in a different atmosphere. So it's only right that I have a different approach.
Oh, 100%.
It's only right that I have a different approach with mine, man. Yeah. I can't be like nobody else, bro. All I can do is what God gave me. Mm. And if I'm wrong, then let him justify that.
Yeah. Yeah.
If I'm wrong, let him justify that. You know what I'm saying? If anything you see about Al Harris is wrong, let God be God and let man be lie.
Yeah.
You know? Because I know how it feels, man. I know how it feels to be convicted by the Spirit and not be able to go on because you walking in disobedience. I know how that feel.
Oh yeah.
You know what I mean?
We know how that feels.
For real. So let God deal with me. Let God deal with me, and I'm okay with that. Because he's been doing it all my life.
Yeah.
He ain't never gonna get it wrong. Yeah, never gonna get it wrong, bro. He gonna get it right every time. Mm. No matter what I got experience, he gonna get it right every time. You know? So now I'm getting shipped. I'm getting shipped. And I've been steady. No, I'm not getting shipped at this time. But one of the guys that's the head speaker in the prayer and share group, he getting shipped. He came to me. He said, "Listen," he said, "God put it on my heart because I'm leaving tomorrow, man. God put it on my heart, man, to ask that you lead the prayer and share. You know, while I'm gone, bro. I didn't have no recollection of how to lead nothing, bro, but myself in trouble." But I did have a relationship with God. That's really all you need.
It's true.
A relationship with God. And the willingness to dig in that word and to obtain knowledge and to fellowship with like-minded people, like-hearted people, you know, and soak in as much as you can about the truth of the gospel, the truth of the salvation. Mm-hmm. A spirit cannot operate in this world without a body. Mm-hmm. Present yourself holy and acceptable unto God, which is your reasonable service. You know what I'm saying? Like, if God is going to do anything in the earth, he has to do it through me. He has to do it through you.
I agree 100%.
And that's what we got to understand, bro. Mm-hmm. It's needful for me to live up, to try my best to live up to a standard that God is expecting from me. Why? Because it's a way that he wants to operate in the earth, and he can't do it unless I present myself.
Yeah.
We got to show up for God. He showed up for us.
I agree.
He showed up for us.
100%.
You know? So yeah, I'm getting deep into it, man. And I'm loving God, man. And I'm hating evil. I'm looking around me, man, and it's like I'm watching horror movies sometimes, man. I'm watching movies or something, man. He allowed me to be a spectator. Mm. I just watch stuff and I soak in information. I don't say nothing, and I don't see nothing, and I don't hear nothing, you know. Yeah, but I hear it all. I see it all, you know. I hear it all and I see it all, man. And I was just soaking in this stuff. It was survival. In there. It was survival. man.
Well, and there's some times in life that the only thing you can do is survive.
I agree with that.
There's been many a life low spots that
I agree
just survived. So you get out of jail, would you say you've never looked back?
No, bro. I was released. Bro, what time is it? Yeah, I'm gonna have to, because if I go into this, bro, I know I'm gonna run over. But listen, because it's a lot. It's a lot. Tim and Abby Porter, I have to say this. They were shout out to Tim and Abby Porter. They were ministers in the prison ministry. And they would come and see the inmates, you know. And at this point, I was in Pickens County Stockade. Because of my custody level, I had to drop. So I'm being shipped here and there. And that's that was so symbolic of my childhood, because I was never stable when I came up. You know what I'm saying? So now when I get in prison, I'm being shipped from yard to yard, never stable. You know what I'm saying? Me old grown now with my wife and children, this is the only time I've ever been stable. And they mean so much to me. But Tim and Abby Porter, they were prison ministers. So they came in, they took a liking to me. You know what I'm saying? So whenever they would come in, it would be us three, me, Tim, and Abby, you know. And it would be a good feeling. Tim came to me one day, you know you go off for parole soon, September. And I said, no, I knew, but it wasn't in my mind, you know what I'm saying? Because I'm bidding now. I done been five and some change in.
You got used to it.
A couple years, I'll be going home anyway. Yeah. You know what I'm saying?
Your time gets easier when you leave the world out there.
Yeah, you're right. And that's what bidding is. You know what I'm saying? That's what bidding is. You can't just go thinking that, okay, you got to know how to bid, bro. Mm-hmm. But anyway, I said, I wasn't even thinking about it. He said, yeah. So Miss Abby, she say, Tim said, Miss Abby, she's going to come with you. I said, okay. Yeah, absolutely. Yeah. So Miss Abby was there. Miss Mills was there. Elder Dennis was there. My mama was there. And out of 14 guys, I'm the only one that made it that day.
Favor.
I'm the only one that made parole that
God's
day, bro.
God's favor.
So Miss Abby, she looked at me. She said, where you going? I could have went with my mom, you know what I'm saying? But my mom, she still stayed in the hood area. You know what I'm saying? Stuff like that. And that's what I told her. I said, yeah, I think I'm going to go stay with my mom, man. She said, what if I told you God said you're supposed to come live with us? Here I am, 30 years old, man. I done did most of my 20s. I got locked up. I was 22 going on 23. I done did most of my 20s in the penitentiary. They don't know me from a can of paint. All they know is what they seen in the penitentiary. I said, no, I can't do that. She looked at me with tears in her eyes. She said, Al, God said you're supposed to live with us. I looked at Tim. He said, you heard her. He said, you heard what she said. So I moved in with Tim and Abby Porter. I lived there for a year.
They're pastors.
They are pastors. They're pastors of the Bridge Church. Okay. The Bridge Church, as a matter of fact, man.
South Carolina.
And I'm so proud of Tim and Abby Porter. I'm so proud of Tim and Abby Porter. They'll always be an intricate part of my life. And not only that, but we're not finished. We got work to do. Tim and Abby Porter, we got work to do. You know, I will not just disregard that connection that God allowed to happen. And think that God is just finished with that.
Yeah.
Nah, that ain't how God worked. I'm looking at other situations in my that ain't how God worked. You know, he's not finished with us. But anyway, yes. So they are the senior pastors at the Bridge Church in Easley now, and I'm so proud of Tim and Abby Porter. But I lived with Tim and Abby Porter for a year. Within that year, I went to Bible college. Covenant Theological Seminary. I went to Bible college. I went there for a couple semesters. I think I'm more of a in the field type guy. I mean, the classroom was cool. I gained knowledge of a few things. You know what I'm saying? We had books galore, and I had to learn, read so much. You know
what
I'm saying?
That's where mine's from.
Yeah, Covenant Theological. Yeah. Danny Parton. Shout out Danny Parton, man. Because all of these men have been very intricate in my growth. Very intricate in my growth. So after that two semesters of Bible college, I left it. Tim taught me HVAC work. So now we're doing heat and air. You know what I'm saying? I'm putting in units. I'm the crawl spaces. I'm tying in the filter things, man. Whatever you call
the
them,
duck
man.
Work.
Duct work.
Yeah. Duct work.
That's right. I'm tying in the duct work now. You know what I'm saying? And stuff like that, man. I'm learning these things.
Bro, we've had a woodworker, a duct worker, and a meat plug.
Yeah. I'm telling you, bro. Not only that, but I set mobile homes too with Danny Merck.
Hey, that's good money.
I did that for 3 years. Absolutely.
Yeah, that's good
we
money.
We broke them down, the modular homes, split them in half. We
pulled them.
Yeah, take them to
I've
Weber.
I've done that.
Put the footers. We set them up, jack them up.
That ain't easy work either.
Lag the bottoms, lag the top, close the roof, man, put the shingles on. I did all that, bro. I set mobile homes for 3 years. And like I said, I seen Jesus everywhere. Everywhere in my life, man. When the word says that the steps of the righteous are ordered by the Lord, God, your word is a lamp unto my feet and a light unto my path. When I tell you, bro, everything, I didn't plan for none of this, bro. I don't even know these, but you know, these opportunities come. And God is saying, here's a door, open it. Here's the door, open it. You know what I'm saying? Here's the door, open it. So I'm with Tim and Abby, and I'm learning all of these things, y'all. This is what I'm doing with them. You know, and we're growing into a family, you know. Carly, Maggie, Jenna, those are my sisters. Those are Tim and Abby's daughters. It's three of them. Those are my sisters.
Mm-hmm.
You know what I'm saying? Carly, she called me Bubby. You know, I'm her brother. I'm a big brother.
Yeah.
You know what I'm saying? Mag, she just got married. You know what I'm saying? That's my sister.
Yeah.
That's my little sister.
You
know, Jenna, Zach, that's my brother-in-law. You know, we family, man. That's my family, man. You know, and I met my wife, December. And I went to Tim and Abby. I said, I met this girl. She wasn't my wife at the time. She was just, you know, I said, I met this girl, man. And I'm grown, though. You know what I'm saying? So I'm knowing in the back of my head that I'm going to have to be grown. I'm going to have to go out and be grown. I'm going to have to be a man. You know what I'm saying? I'm knowing this. So I told him, you know, I'm thinking about, you know, branching off, man, and leaving. And, of course, it was sad. It was a sad night. It was a sad day. Man, it was sad after that. You know what I'm saying? Because I really didn't want to leave, you know, but I knew I couldn't stay forever, y'all. You know? So... met my wife December, moved in with her and stuff like that. Now, mind you, I'm a minister now. I'm ministering, I'm writing music, I'm doing all this stuff. And I just moved in with a young lady, you know what I'm saying? And living with her, staying with her, waking up to her, you know. It was about a week. I looked at her, I said, we got to get married. That was my proposal. In the bed, I said, we just rose up. Hey, listen. I looked at her. I said, listen, we got to get married. She said, you serious? I said, yeah, I'm positive, you know, because it was bothering me so much, y'all. Mm-hmm. I said, we got to get married.
It sounds so much like your story too.
Yeah. You know, and then when we got married, I told her to take out the contraceptive, you know, the birth control or whatever, because God had already promised me a daughter. When I was in prison, because I had a daughter when I was in prison that I didn't get to raise, that I didn't get to be there for, you know what I'm saying? So I prayed. I said, God, I want to experience that.
Mm.
I said, Lord, I want to experience that. You know, can you give me that again? And when I got out, I met my wife. You know, after we got married, I told her, you know, take it out. She did, and she was pregnant, bro. Like 2 weeks late. Like we found out like 2 weeks, like within that month or whatever. Like no time. That she was pregnant with my daughter Callie.
That's crazy.
And now my daughter Callie, she'll spit image of me. You know, you know when Pac said, I've been really wanting babies so I could see a part of me that wasn't no way shady.
Yeah.
Don't trust me. You know what I'm saying?
Yeah.
Yo,
that's it.
When I see my daughter.
How many babies were made because of that line?
Yeah. I mean, because I was so hellacious.
Mm-hmm.
I want to see a part of me that's pure,
yeah.
At least close to it. You know what I mean? Because I know what she can be. I know who she can be, and I know what she could do. You know what I'm saying? I took for granted the moments I never wanted. Chose the corner. Now I stand behind the truth like I'm Sojourner. My right hand to your honor. Not quite 10, but a runner. And them pills got his mama to struggle real for a woman. As she vomit, the craving and heightened, and she in bondage. Now her son got a fight with negative comments. Cold nights eating ramen, got her clutching on his stomach. His mama made him a promise, and he trusted she would honor it. She all he got besides the block. It's only right that he devised a plot. No time to stop. Get it with his homies and divide the pot and dodge the cops. He catch a bid, then who gon' ride it out? I highly doubt they send him a letter or even shout him out. Most of his life been in a group home while mama cutting coupons with hopes that she can save him, but he too gone. Adjusting to the new norm with no destination. How could we move on? A pill she can't take, it's just too strong. You know what I mean? And those are real life experiences that you merge into music, that you merge into real life situations, bro. Mm-hmm. You know what I'm saying, bro? You know? That's what God called me to be. That's what he called me to do. Mm-hmm. You know what I'm saying? To grab real scenarios that can give people a different perspective, but present it to them in a way that they accept it.
Yeah. Yeah, and see, a lot of people don't, you know, one thing that I heard in that, a lot of people out here, when you're in that life and you're running with these folks, these are your people that you trust.
Right.
And you do a whole lot of dirt, and you, but when you go down the road, they're not going to do that with you.
Mm-mm.
They won't even send you a letter or any money.
Bro.
You know, and that's one of the things that I heard in that real life. That came from you being down that road.
And I know
and
that.
And you
now.
Looking back, thinking, where's all these folks that was saying they were, you know, ride or die with me, nobody. And ain't nobody here.
Nobody.
And you have to experience that to know. I remember I was down the road and, you know, these young kids in there talking about all this stuff. And it's like, where you doing all this, but who's with you? You ain't even got no money on
Come
the
on,
books.
Bro.
And you talking about killing for these folks.
Bro, that's a reality check.
Yeah.
That's a gut shot, bro. That's a gut shot. And then at that moment, right at that moment, you realize I've been living for the wrong people.
Mm-hmm. Yes.
I've been living for the wrong people. They don't care nothing about me.
Yep.
You know
Can't.
What I'm saying? No.
Can't.
Bro, here's the deal, bro. Like, you're just going to have to come back.
Okay, we could do that, bro. You already know. We could do that.
You're gonna have to come back.
I mean, I think so too,
and
because
it don't
undone,
necessarily
bro.
Have to be
it's undone though.
Your testimony. But what I'm saying, man, is just like we've been sitting here for a couple hours. It feels like a few minutes, and like, bro,
right?
Like,
that's
I'm
what I'm
telling
saying.
You right now, man. Like, this is one this episode, bro.
Yeah,
is about to hit in a few weeks, and
but before you go, I do want to hear your freestyle.
Bro, he just killed it.
Okay.
Do you want me to put you on some music? You want me to pick a random beat? Or
you got a beat you want to...
Or you got one.
I mean, you could just pick one. Just tell me right, what it is.
Let me see what I can pick. Man, I'm so... Dog, when and I mean this from the bottom of my heart, I love you.
Right. I love you too.
And, you know, our paths ain't... You know, one that we get to chop it up all the time. But I'm telling you, bro, I'm a better person when I'm around you. Like whatever's on, like I feel like this is what I say. When I'm around Al, my baby jumps.
Right. Yeah.
You know what I'm talking about.
When I first heard you speak, I said that, bro.
Our
baby
it's like, leap. It's like yeah, it's
that
like
Marion Elizabeth.
Mary and Elizabeth.
Same thing with him when he first spoke.
But crazy. Like here's the thing, bro. You ain't never going to live in your potential if you don't get around people who make your baby jump.
I agree.
Know how many, you are sitting in my baby that people told me at one time could not happen.
Mm.
And it's people like you that when I got around, gave me hope to go one more day because there's been many a times I've sat in this place. We got 57 men. There was a time when I sat in this place years before I even knew how we were going to get it started with carpet pulled up, laying, crying, thinking, what have I done got myself into? And so, like, here's the truth, bro. You've helped a lot of people, but I need you to know that in my journey, there's been times where because of something you said or being around you, gave me that hope of I'm not quitting.
Yeah,
that's good.
Yeah. We gonna make it. You know, like Jadakiss. It's funny when you say New York. I took you know Heath White. It's a guy. He came from Yonkers. I was running a facility in Florence. He came in. He was probably what 40s, late 40s. Yeah. I was 20, 25 or something, and he got sober, crack. Got sober, started to change his life. He got to a part of his program where he had to go back to Yonkers and make restitution. Guess what? Guess who took him? Me.
Mm-hmm. That's great.
He takes me. Now, listen, he takes me. This was the coolest experience I still had. I still talk about this. I'm walking down the block in Yonkers, and I walk by a liquor store, and I grabbed him because on the milk carton was Jadakiss smoking a blunt. And I couldn't believe it. I was like, Heath, bro, look, this Jada. He's like, oh, that's my dog. And he introduced me to Jada Chris and Yonker. So when you were telling that story,
shout out Jada, man.
I thought about that, bro.
Blue Jan Styles.
Yeah, yeah, I thought about that. But Yeah, so I love you, dog.
Man, I love you too.
Whatever, yeah. You know, here's my prayer for you, is that you'll continue to stay planted by the river, and that your leaves will never wither, and that in every season you will bear fruit. And here's the thing. When you do that, everything you touch will prosper.
Amen.
I believe that, man. And whatever territory you ain't taking, I pray that God gives you everything your feet tread upon.
Amen.
Amen. All right.
Amen.
Well, let's see here.
Amen. I receive that in the name of Jesus.
And you got to come back,
dog.
That's
all I stand on. I stand. Yeah, definitely.
You got to come back, man. Chase was devastated. He's like, man, he wanted to be here.
Oh,
he loves
yeah,
you
that's
too,
my
bro.
Dog, man.
Yeah, he loves you too. And yeah. And while we're on that, shout out to Culture Shock Music, because they are a big sponsor of Sober the Podcast. And, you know, we love Chase and what God's doing in his life. So shout out to Culture Shock Music.
Absolutely.
Yep. All right. So I don't know if this is anything, but the first beat that came up in my mind was Nas One Mic.
Okay.
Is that tough?
Let's do it.
Okay. Let's see if I can find the instrumental.
You put me on the spot, then.
Bro, I'm going to be honest. I've listened to a lot of rappers, but, bro, you one of my favorites.
That mean a lot to me.
You one of my favorites, bro. The way you put words together, the pain in your voice.
I got to, yeah. Listen, that Nas one mic? Come on, man.
I gotta find it, bro.
Okay.
I don't know why.
Yeah, do what you gotta do. But yeah, man. I would see a lot of people don't know. That's who I got my. You know, it was Nas, it was Jada. It was later on it was Jay-Z. But there are artists, Tupac of course, there are artists that have cultivated my my writing process, not just the writing process, but my rapping process, man. And
your craft.
Yeah, my craft. And I've been able to develop my own, though. I've been able to develop my own, but those were like blueprints for me. You know, those guys were like blueprints for me. You know, and I'm not debating their music or whether their message is suitable for. I'm not saying that. You know, I'm not saying that right now. I'm just saying their artistic skills, you know, their artistic skill set, you know what I'm saying? That's what helped develop my delivery, my flow, my cadence. absolutely. But everybody know where I stand when it comes to, having a message through music and making sure that message feeds our next generation. It inspires our next generation. It builds them up, man. And it has the ability to point out their identity.
Yeah. What up? So I can't find that one. What
right,
about?
So why don't you spit us a verse then? We don't need the music.
I got something
about.
Like this.
Okay, I could do it. I like that. No role models of rappers they can look up to. Cash inside of the duffel. With rap we made a truck. Hold on. Back. Yeah. Let me catch it. Let me catch it. No role models of rappers they can look up to. Cash inside of the duffel. With rap we made a sport. They throw flags when they rush you. They don't love you. Where every bad hand keep it shuffled. Your man a loose cannon, keep a shovel. I took my life for granted, but I came out of that rubble. Even with a rocky landing, I made it without a scuffle. Can you hear when the guns blow? When the shots fall? When the smoke clear? Who should I fear but God? I wipe the tears from their eyes, building a bridge through the fire. Hoping they can cross over, homie. I fear for their lives. It's deeper than music when you hold an influence. You made them do it. Came with suicidal thoughts and attempts, and I prayed them through it. That can build a hate for music, but we block evolution. Embrace the newest. Study your music to make you prove it.
Yeah.
Bro.
Yeah.
Bro, Al Harris. Al Harris. Al Harris. All right. Well, we love you, bro. And
man, I love y'all, man.
And you gotta
nice
come
to meet
back.
You, bro.
I love y'all, man.
Yeah, so good.
Nice to meet
so
you
good
too,
to
bro.
Have you here.
I sense your spirit,
and
man, I sense it.
Guys, this is it. Al Harris, look him up.
For sure.
Sheesh.